Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. The event will start in a few moments. Please allow me to provide you with some information regarding today's virtual discussion session. The event will start at 10 a.m. Jakarta time. This event is in a webinar mode, so you can post your question on the Q&A chat box below your screen throughout the entire session. Thank you. Once again, good morning, ladies and gentlemen. The event will start in a few moments. And please allow me to provide you with some information regarding today's virtual discussion session. The event will start at 10 a.m. Jakarta time. And this event is in a webinar mode. So you can post your question on the Q&A chat box below your screen throughout the entire session. Thank you. Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to the International Seminar Virtual Learning Exchange on Youth Engagement in Disaster Preparedness and Response between the Government of Indonesia and Government of Bangladesh. The main objectives of this learning exchange are the establishment of a peer learning platform on disaster management and climate change adaptation between Indonesia and Bangladesh, the identification and documentation of methods to assist the growth of youth participation in disaster preparedness and response in the region, the documentation of lessons learned from the community level on youth and women engagement to be used for multi-hazard disaster management advocacy in the context of the COVID-19 pandemic. This event is moderated in a webinar mode, so you may ask your question, post your question during the session through the Q&A box below your screen. The selected questions will be answered directly by the speakers during the session. So ladies and gentlemen, the first agenda is opening remarks from the Country Director, World Food Program Representative, Indonesia Country Office, to Mrs. Krista Reder. The time is yours.
Thank you very much, Mr. Ahmadul Haq, Director Cyclone Preparedness Program and Deputy Secretary, Ministry of Disaster Management and Relief of the People's Republic of Bangladesh. Pak Ian Kusmadiana, Director of Social Protection for Disaster Victims, Ministry of Social Affairs of the Republic of Indonesia. Representatives of the Directorate General, Social Protection and Social Security in the Ministry of Social Affairs here in Indonesia, and representatives of the Planning Bureau, especially from the International Cooperation Division. Tagana representatives, representatives from Bangladesh and Indonesia government and WFP, I especially acknowledge my colleague Pete Fochten, who leads the WFP Bangladesh team. And I heard that Mr. Moksin, who used to be Secretary Disaster Management and Relief, is now working as senior advisor in WFP Bangladesh and is also present. A very good morning. Assalamualaikum. Selamat pagi, Shubuh Shokal. I warmly welcome you to this exchange between the representatives of the Government of the People's Republic of Bangladesh and the Government of the Republic of Indonesia on enhancing disaster management capacity through youth engagement. But let me take this opportunity also to congratulate the two countries for their demonstrated leadership in crisis prevention and response. As you may well know, on 14th of April, the United Nations Secretary General appointed Prime Minister Sheikh Hasina and President Joko Widodo as members of the Champions Group of the UN Global Crisis Response. Globally, disasters are amongst the main drivers of hunger and malnutrition. The Asia and the Pacific region ranks among the world's most vulnerable to natural hazards and the increase of large-scale disasters due to climate change events, and this is considerable. The aftermath of every disaster leaves a trail of destruction, the loss of lives and livelihoods, the destruction of houses, productive assets, and infrastructures, and the disruption of food and water supply. Disasters also exacerbate the underlying hunger and poverty. Developing adequate preparatory measures to build disaster-resilient communities in such a challenging environment is a critical priority to save lives and protect livelihoods. We have witnessed the emergence of youth as an agent of change worldwide. In 2015, there were 1.2 billion youth aged 15 to 24 years globally, accounting for one out of every six people worldwide. By 2030, the number of youth is projected to have grown by 7% to nearly 1.3 billion. In Indonesia, where young people are defined as those aged 10 to 24, youth represent more than one quarter of the population. Similarly, Bangladesh has a significant youth population. As future leaders, it is important that youth are empowered with the knowledge of their rights, equipped with leadership skills, and provided with opportunities to engage meaningfully, including for resilience building and disaster preparedness. The youth will also have to address the alarming consequences of climate change, which they are inheriting from this and previous generations. Both Indonesia and Bangladesh share similarities, not only in the large size of their young population, but also in their exposure to multi-hazard disasters and climate-related events like floods, cyclones, and droughts. Both countries also have experienced mega disasters, claiming hundreds of thousands of lives. The 1970 cyclone in Bangladesh killed an estimated 300,000 to 500,000 people. The 2004 tsunami in Aceh claimed more than 228,000 lives. Both countries have subsequently established excellent preparedness systems to save people and critical assets as a measure to deal with the constant threat of natural hazards. Both countries also have a significant youth population that can engage in disaster preparedness efforts. It is vital to provide an opportunity for these young adults to work together for a resilient future. In disaster situations, both young men and young women are needed to attend to other men and women among potentially affected populations. This youth has the determination and the physical strength and ability to help the elderly, children, and the disabled, and not only them. The government of Indonesia has prioritized disaster risk management and climate change adaptation in its National Medium-Term Development Plan 2020-2024 and is empowering youth as part of the TAGANA, that is Disaster Youth Volunteer Program, led by the Ministry of Social Affairs. Since its establishment in 2004, the TAGANA program has trained more than 39,000 volunteers across the nation. Bangladesh is well known for its cyclone preparedness program, engaging with 50,000 disaster volunteers. It is apparent that both countries have long-standing experience and have made a significant investment in developing capacity in disaster preparedness and response, including youth engagement. For the World Food Programme, working to prevent, mitigate, and prepare for disasters is an is an essential part of its mandate to achieve Sustainable Development Goal 2, Zero Hunger. In Indonesia, WFP collaborates with the Ministry of Social Affairs in disaster preparedness and response to enhance the capacity of the disaster-ready youth system, community-based disaster risk management initiatives, and the development of adaptive social protection. Today's event will focus on launching a peer learning platform and initiating a dialogue on policies and programs to support disaster preparedness and response management with youth at their center. It will highlight youth engagement strategies, exchange of knowledge and experience on disaster preparedness and response, and explore opportunities for continued South-South learning exchanges on youth engagement in the region. The South-South and Triangular Cooperation Modality provides a platform for exchanging knowledge and experience between countries with similar conditions and challenges. The World Food Programme is leveraging South-South and Triangular Cooperation opportunities to provide technical assistance and contribute to policy dialogue. Today's virtual exchange is an important milestone in facilitating and strengthening South-South cooperation in support of the government of Indonesia and the government of Bangladesh. WFP Indonesia remains highly committed to continued exchange through South-South platforms to enhance programs for improved youth engagement in disaster preparedness and response. We thank the South-South and Triangular Cooperation Opportunity Fund established in WFP for the support and flexibility to make this exchange possible. Thank you. We look forward to a fruitful exchange.
Thank you, Mrs. Krista Reder, for the remarks. And moving along to our next agenda, we will together listen to the remarks from the Deputy Country Director, Program and Strategy, World Food Program, Bangladesh Country Office. For Mr. Pete Fogten, the time is yours.
Terima kasih, Ibu. Thank you, Krista. Pak Ian Kusmadiana, Director of the Social Protection for Natural Disaster Victims of the Ministry of Social Affairs of the Government of Indonesia. Mr. Ahmadul Haq, Director of the Cyclone Preparedness Program from the Ministry of Disaster Management and Relief, Government of Indonesia. Krista Reder, WFP representative. Distinguished guest from the governments of Indonesia and the government of Bangladesh. Dear youth volunteers of Indonesia and Bangladesh, and colleagues from both countries, a very good morning to you all and welcome. Both Indonesia and Bangladesh are actually countries that are very close to my heart. Indonesia is the first country where I worked abroad. I came the first time to Indonesia in 1988 when I went to live in a small village called Talibura in the Kabupaten of Sika, in Maumere, on the island of Flores in southeast Indonesia. I left Flores 3 years later, in 1991, and I'm sure my Indonesian colleagues will remember 1992, Flores then was hit by a major earthquake and tsunami that seriously affected the island and killed thousands of people. I went back there in 93 when I was assigned again to Indonesia, and I saw how the village where I had lived, how my friends there, their houses had been destroyed, and how a few kilometers away where there used to be a big plantation, there was now a resettlement village built for victims of this tsunami. I'm now in Bangladesh, a country where I've arrived since 2019. And Bangladesh, in fact, is a country that I remember from my very young days. If I look back, I must have been 7 or 8 years old, and I went to my grandmother's place because she had a television. We didn't have a television at home. And of course, in those days, watching the television news was a very important event every day. And that's where I remember seeing on this black and white screen people affected, displaced in destroyed villages of what, as I now realize, must have been the aftermath of Cyclone Bola. Cyclone Bola, as Krista mentioned, is one of the deadliest cyclones which is on record, having killed more than 300,000 people. So both Indonesia and Bangladesh are regularly, unfortunately, the victim of natural disasters. And this is because of their geographical location, the characteristics of the country. Indonesia has 17,500 islands. It's sitting on the Ring of Fire, so very prone to earthquakes. It gets hit regularly by tropical storms, cyclones, droughts. Bangladesh is a low-lying country, which is basically one large river delta, where the waters of several of the largest rivers of the world are coming together and discharging all in the Bay of Bengal. So in Bangladesh, disasters can come both from the north along the river, but also from the south when the cyclones are forming in the Bay of Bengal and hitting up towards the land. Bangladesh, as a riverine country, normally has around 7% of its land mass, which is rivers. But during the monsoon season and during the flooding season, that can go up to 30-35% of the country, which is inundated by floods. Bangladesh is also the most densely populated country on the planet, other than for some small city-states like Singapore. It's vulnerable to earthquakes, and now with the effects of climate change, things are getting even more critical. We have rising sea levels, we have rising saltwater levels. So this is a country that regularly has to deal with disasters, and like it or not, the people and the government of Bangladesh have to learn how to deal with it. So both in Indonesia and Bangladesh, people have a history of dealing with disasters, small ones, but also massive ones, and being prepared to that. Both governments are strengthening the infrastructure, putting in place systems, strengthening human capacity to combat these disasters. All this with the aim to reduce, first of all, losses of life, losses of livelihoods and assets of the citizens of the country, and also the impact of these disasters on public infrastructure. When I look at what Bangladesh has achieved in the 50 years since its independence, everybody has to be impressed. Like I said, Bola, which was just a few months before the independence of the nation, it killed more than 300,000 people. Now, when we have a cyclone coming, the casualties are single digits, at the most low tens of casualties. And this is thanks to the measures and the infrastructures that the government has put in place on dealing with these disasters. So when the colleagues of our office in Indonesia asked whether we could try to bring together the governments of Bangladesh and Indonesia to discuss about their approaches, I could only think that this is a great idea. Not only because, having worked for many years in the UN system, I realized that while I can give wonderful speeches and explain how things work, people believe me but they also have a bit of a grain of of cynicism in that way that they know, sure, as the UN, we can have the privilege of focusing on a smaller group of people, on bringing all the resources that are needed, on bringing funding that is needed. But as a government, you cannot say, let me look at this small group and forget the rest of the people. You have a responsibility for your entire population, for an entire country. You also are dealing with budgetary constraints. A dollar that you invest in one place is a dollar you cannot invest in anything else. And there are so many competing needs, of course. And what you do isn't always recognized. When there is a disaster, you get criticized. But all the times, all the other disasters that you've managed to help to contain, that's only considered as normal. So bringing together people from governments creates this opportunity that you can talk to your peers, that you can talk to people who face the same reality as you do. Different context, different country, but very much similar in a lot of ways. So bringing together both Indonesia and Bangladesh allows us to have these exchanges. From Bangladesh, I'm joined today with some of the colleagues, especially from the Ministry of Disaster Management and Relief. And I would like to mention and recognize that this ministry won the United Nations Public Service Award in 2021 for its unprecedented progress in women's empowerment in disaster management. Women that we know who are at the key of receiving the impact, also at the key of responding to disaster. So this award was undoubtedly a big recognition of the ministry's continuous efforts in improving the ways and means for managing natural disasters. So today we have the privilege of having Mr. Ahmadul Haq with us. He's the director of the Cyclone Preparedness Program and deputy secretary of the ministry. He's joined by Mr. Mohammed Ghulam Kibria, deputy director of Cyclone Preparedness Program in Khulna. Khulna is the third largest city of Bangladesh. It's in the southwestern part of the country. And that is the area that is subjected on an annual basis to cyclones coming up from the Bay of Bengal, as well as the floods coming down from the Himalayas. He is further joined by the District Relief and Rehabilitation Officer of Khulna, Mr. Ranjit Kumar Sakar, and two volunteers of the Cyclone Preparedness Program, Ms. Roshan Arakeya and Mr. Masum Billa. Mr. Masum is also unit team leader of the volunteers of Shamnagar. We also have the pleasure of having Mr. Mohammed Abdul Hai with us. He's the District Relief and Rehabilitation Officer in Kurigram. Kurigram is a district in northern Bangladesh along the border with India. Several rivers flow through the center of this district, including the Brahmaputra, which flows down all the way from China, from the Tibetan Plateau. And as such, Kurigram experienced floodings on an annual basis, coinciding with the monsoons, bringing in large amounts of waters. Mr. Hai is joined by two volunteers of the forecast-based financing program in Kurigram, Ms. Moshini Khatun and Mr. Mohammed Dulai Mia. I'm also coming with a number of my WFP colleagues, but they will introduce themselves when they are speaking. Bangladesh, so we will hear today of how Bangladesh is preparing for cyclones that affect the coastal belt, especially in the southwestern part of the country. And we'll hear about some of the newer approaches in how Bangladesh deals with disasters, especially with those riverine floods up in the north. This is with a technique as part of the anticipatory actions toolbox named forecast-based financing, wherein weather-based forecasts are used to set triggers when to release funding before the disaster actually strikes, so that people can be better prepared. This is combined with messaging and an important role for these youth volunteers that we have. We've had a number of years of experience with this approach, and we are now taking this further to some of the southern parts of the country, more particularly in Cox's Bazar district, the district where we have a large influx of Rohingya refugees, but a district that is also hit by floods, cyclones, flash floods, tidal surges. So we're the ministry is now trying to see how these approaches can be adapted to this kind of context. So I hope that we can have a very good discussion and exchange today, and that from this discussion, new ideas might germinate on how things can be approached, maybe in a different way, or to confirm that indeed we're moving ahead on the right path. So thank you very much for this opportunity. And I look forward to having a great session with you. Terima kasih, Ibu.
Thank you, Mr. Pete Fogton, for the remarks. So ladies and gentlemen, moving along to our next agenda, we will together listen to the remarks from the Director of Cyclone Preparedness Program and Deputy Secretary of the Ministry of Disaster Management and Relief, Bangladesh. For Mr. Ahmadul Haq, the time is yours.
Thank you, moderator. Good morning from Bangladesh, dear esteemed panelists, distinguished participants, and all viewers from Indonesia and Bangladesh. It's a wonderful opportunity to share disaster management knowledge between two disaster-prone countries, Indonesia and Bangladesh. I must be thankful to Mr. Pete and Krista from WFP. They have used some wonderful words about our disaster preparedness and going forward for further development. Thank you, everybody. In my opening remarks, I will focus some of the disaster profile of our country. We are mainly in disasters like all our natural disasters like cyclone, flood, flash floods, salinity intrusion, drought, lightning, and landslides are our newer concerns, very big concerns. And of course, we are always in a threat of earthquake. The vulnerability profile of in our country is like the global warming is climate change, as for everyone, geographical location, funnel shape of the Bay of Bengal, deltaic landscape, dominance of flat plains, low elevation up from the sea, high population density. It is a very big concern. And of course, definitely there is rural poverty. Now I'll focus on some intervention and approach that we can share as success. The community-based disaster risk reduction mechanism Bangladesh adopted in the aftermath of the one of the deadliest catastrophe the earth ever faced, the Bola cyclone, 1970. It caused over a million deaths, followed by mammoth life and property casualties. CPP, Cyclone Preparedness Program, is the best example of community-led and engaged DRR, disaster risk reduction. To reach the people through their people with risk awareness, preparedness, and response tools. CPP basically works in the first three tiers of disaster management cycle, like mitigation, preparedness, and response. It is definitely a government organization that originated as Red Cross Red Crescent Initiative, covering the whole coastline of Bangladesh. I can say the south portion. What we say is saw in 1970, the base year of our disaster management evolution. We were not independent in that time. There was a zero management in disaster management. No early warning system, no community awareness and preparedness or engagement, no disaster volunteerism structure, no people-centric management, I can say. There should be a way to create change by and for the community itself. This is the core essence of sector preparedness program, which is dedicating to reducing loss of life and property from cyclones in Bangladesh, bringing out and organizing the strength of at-risk communities. Through its effort in preparing and training the population in advance, the CPP is also able to nurture resilience. That has now become a tradition and an inseparable and priceless social capital. I repeat the word social capital of the people of Bangladesh. I have heard some age dividend is Bangladesh enjoying. Yes, age dividend youth participation. We are also fortunate enough. Our 75% of current 76,000 volunteers are youth. Though we are 50 years old organization, regular reconstruction of the volunteer units helped us to gain this age dividend. Moreover, we recently succeeded at women empowerment drive. Through that effort, we enrolled around 20,000 new fresh young women volunteers. Our recently included multi-hazard response elite units are also from youth groups. We are empowered with around 7,000 young souls in these units. Some of our young blood may talk in the experience sharing option. Recently, Ministry of Disaster Management and Relief established flood preparedness program volunteers. Some young volunteer force are coming into our action of disaster management. Women empowerment and engagement, I have said earlier, and some of the speakers said about United Nations Public Service Award 2021 achieved by our ministry. The title was the Women Empowerment in Cyclone Preparedness Program. The Women Empowerment in Cyclone Preparedness Program brought us this pride. I will share some lesson learned in the later portion if I get opportunity to talk. Now I will talk about this some salient feature about forecast-based financing. Early warning, early action is always a concern in our disaster management. Forecast-based financing and actions have already been streamlined with our national mechanism. We incorporated in our standing orders on disaster 2019. I have heard Mr. Mohsin, our ex-secretary, I'm proud to work under him. He actually did these massive changes in our disaster management. Hazard-specific FBF strategies are being developed and formulated under government guidance. We acknowledge WFP, Red Cross, Red Crescent, and other stakeholders, forecast-based financing actions. WFP's FBF engagement mostly covering our flood-prone north or northwest or middle region. Forecast-based financing is a great example of our country's participatory disaster management approach. Government is taking all the responsibilities, but we recognize and motivate private initiatives, counting these as contemporary, complementary to government's effort. Other than the regular humanitarian support from national exchequer, we also established National Disaster Management Emergency Fund, which is comprised of government fund and national and international corporate and individual contributions. That's all about my opening talks. I'll be waiting happily to hear some interesting discussion from others. And I also apologize for my absence for few minutes to attend another engagement. Then I will be, I hopefully join. Good day, everybody.
Thank you, Mr. Amadou Haq, for the opening remarks. So, ladies and gentlemen, following the next agenda, we will together listen to the remarks from the Director of Social Protection for Natural Disaster Victim of the Ministry of Social Affairs Indonesia, for Mr. Dr. Andes Ian Kusmadiana, MPSSP. The time is yours.
Baik, terima kasih. Kami sampaikan kepada Bapak Amadou Haq yang telah memberikan gambaran bagaimana pelanggan bencana di Bangladesh, juga kepada Ibu Krista Reden juga tadi menyampaikan bagaimana beliau cerita pengalamannya, beliau selaku WFP representative di Indonesia, kantor Indonesia, dan juga kepada Bapak Pete Wotton yang tadi menyampaikan pengalamannya di Indonesia dan juga pengalamannya melaksanakan kegiatan di Bangladesh. Kegiatan ini adalah bagian dari South and Triangular Cooperation yang bertujuan mempromosikan kolaborasi dan memfasilitasi pertukaran dan pengalaman tentunya antar negara, dalam hal ini Indonesia dan Bangladesh, yang memiliki kesamaan sedikitnya tadi disampaikan tentang bagaimana sering terjadinya bencana alam oleh tadi Pak Ahmadu, dan juga hal keterkepaparan terhadap multi bahaya dan juga bencana yang dipicu oleh perubahan iklim. Tadi ada angin topan, ada banjir yang sudah disebutkan. Saya kira ini memiliki kesamaan yang sangat dekat dengan kondisi di Indonesia. Sebagai negara kepulauan, kami memiliki potensi bencana seperti itu. Tentunya kedua negara ini juga memiliki populasi kaum muda yang signifikan untuk dilibatkan dalam upaya penanganan bencana. Dan Indonesia tentunya banyak organisasi kepemudaan yang melaksanakan kegiatan penanganan bencana. Khusus di Kementerian Sosial yang dibina oleh Kementerian Sosial, kami mempunyai situasi namanya tanah siaga bencana, akan menjelaskan di bawah. Tapi sebelum itu kami akan menjelaskan bahwa Indonesia sedikit mungkin negaranya adalah negara kepulauan dengan laut yang sangat luas, dan pulau-pulau tadi disebutkan oleh Pak Pit itu sampai dengan 17.000 sampai 20.000, sehingga ini yang mempengaruhi penyebaran penduduk Indonesia dan mempengaruhi pendekatan penanganan bencana dilakukan oleh Indonesia. Dengan situasi seperti itu, maka untuk percepatan dan kecepatan pelayanan penanganan bencana di Indonesia, kami selalu mengedepankan mengenai bagaimana penanganan bencana berbasis masyarakat. Masyarakat tempatkan sebagai, bukan hanya sebagai objek, tetapi sebagai subjek penanganan bencana, agar bisa mereka aktif dan bisa melakukan penanganan bencana sendiri sebelum bantuan dari luar datang. Untuk itulah Kementerian Sosial menggagas, mengkolaborasikan antara pentingnya community base ini dengan peran daripada pemuda, di mana Kementerian Sosial mempunyai tugas pokok dan fungsinya untuk melaksanakan penanganan bencana bidang perlindungan sosial, maka mengkolaborasikan disebut dengan Taruna Siaga Bencana. Tahun 2000 sebelumnya Indonesia itu mempunyai, di Kementerian Sosial mempunyai penanganan bencana berbasis masyarakat yang, mohon maaf, dari angkatan atau dari usia tidak dibatasi, tapi tidak muda, tetapi dari banyak orang tua dan sebagainya. Kemudian Sejarah membuktikan bahwa mereka perlahan-perlahan itu menghilang dengan sendiri, dan para relawan ini sekarang sudah hilang sesuai dengan usia. Maka dari pengalaman itu, dengan di samping tadi disampaikan saya terkait dengan kondisi di Indonesia serta perlunya keterlibatan pemuda, maka kami menginisiasi melaksanakan kegiatan atau membentuk suatu Taruna Siaga Bencana, yaitu relawan yang memang dia ini adalah relawan murni dari masyarakat untuk melakukan penanggulangan bencana yang dibina oleh Kementerian Sosial. Dan juga ada Kampung Siaga Bencana, yaitu bedanya Tagana itu person yang ada di lokasi-lokasi di Indonesia, tersebar seluruh Indonesia, sekarang ada 39.000 di Indonesia, dan kalau Kampung Siaga Bencana itu tim yang ada sebenarnya antara Tagana dan KSB atau Kampung Siaga Bencana itu lebih frontliner Kampung Siaga Bencana karena dia berada di desa-desa setempat. Nah, ini yang dilakukan oleh Kementerian Sosial melalui pilar sosialnya Tagana dan Kampung Siaga Bencana untuk percepatan penanggulangan bencana berbasis masyarakat. Karena kami mendekatkan metode seperti itu yang dilakukan oleh Kementerian Sosial. Nah, Tagana itu berdiri tanggal 24 Maret tahun 2024, ya lebih cepat sedikit dari kejadian bencana tsunami di Aceh. Ketika itu kami sedang di Bandung melaksanakan kegiatan pembentukan Taruna Siaga Bencana dibentuk, dan kemudian dari situ kita berkumpul waktu itu hanya 64 orang, dan kita memulai kegiatan dari jumlah sedikit, dan syukur alhamdulillah sampai dengan saat ini mereka sudah bisa berkembang secara profesional dan dari kuantitas maupun kualitas, sampai saat ini sudah menjadi 39.000. Dan ini dikendalikan oleh Kementerian Sosial untuk penanggulangan bencana seluruh Indonesia. Ditambah lagi sekarang, tahun 2011, kita memulai melalui program Kampung Siaga Bencana yang sudah dimiliki oleh Kementerian Sosial, menambah lagi bagaimana metode pendekatan-pendekatan untuk percepatan penanggulangan bencana berbasis masyarakat. Dan ini dari bukti yang kita lakukan sekarang atau bukti empiris yang ada bahwa kejadian bencana saat ini di Indonesia itu sangat dibantu oleh Tagana dan Kampung Siaga Bencana. Mereka yang memberikan laporan pertama terjadi bencana, mereka yang melaporkan dan memberikan perlakuan-perlakuan atau tindakan-tindakan kedaruratan lebih awal, dan juga dengan Kampung Siaga Bencana, sebelum bantuan dari luar datang. Dan inilah yang membuat kecepatan kita lebih cepat untuk melaksanakan penanggulangan bencana. Kemudian, setelah itu kami bagaimana mereka itu di lapangan, mereka di lapangan bergandengan antara Tagana dengan Kampung Siaga Bencana, bahkan Tagana itu merupakan fasilitator dari Kampung Siaga Bencana yang sudah kami bentuk. Nah, mereka kalau ada bencana selalu berkolaborasi, dan mereka sudah dibekali alat, mereka sudah diberikan pengetahuan, mereka diberikan keterampilan, sudah dilatih, hanya diberikan semangat korsa yang sama, sehingga kalau ada bencana, dia langsung berkolaborasi antara Tagana dan Kampung Siaga Bencana di lokasi bencana. Ini yang dilakukan. Dan setelah itu kejadian bencana, kondisi bencana itu terjadi, direspon oleh mereka, maka sambil bergerak, kami melakukan mengaktifasi sistem-sistem yang ada, baik itu di tingkat kabupaten, di tingkat provinsi, di tingkat nasional, untuk mengarahkan kekuatan ke lokasi terjadi bencana. Namun setidaknya sudah dilakukan upaya-upaya awal oleh Tagana maupun Kampung Siaga Bencana. Itulah yang kami lakukan, sistem penanggulangan bencana berbasis masyarakat yang dilakukan oleh Kementerian Sosial di Indonesia ini. Nah, dengan pertemuan ini tentunya kami berharap, kami ingin mengetahui bagaimana penanggulangan bencana yang dilakukan oleh para pemuda di Bangladesh, ya, dan juga bagaimana tentunya kaitannya dengan penanggulangan bencana berbasis masyarakat oleh Bangladesh, sehingga kami ingin memahami situasi seperti di sana, dan kami akan memberikan pengalaman-pengalamannya kepada teman-teman di Bangladesh, dan kami juga akan menerima pengalaman-pengalaman yang ada dari Bangladesh, dan karena itu tentunya untuk perbaikan ke depan bagi kami sendiri dan untuk kemajuan kita bersama secara umum. Nah, ini yang kami lakukan dan kami sampaikan dalam sambutan awal dari kegiatan ini. Bapak Ibu yang kami hormati, selanjutnya kami menyampaikan bahwa Kementerian Sosial juga selain ini juga mempunyai berikan kewenangan sebagai koordinator klaster pengungsian dan perlindungan. Karena di Indonesia ini dalam penanganan bencana dipimpin oleh BNPB dibagi dalam 8 klaster, salah satu klasternya klaster pengungsian dan perlindungan, di mana Kementerian Sosial adalah sebagai koordinator klaster pengungsian dan perlindungan. Inilah tempatnya bagaimana kita berkoordinasi antara beberapa pihak, baik itu pemerintah, baik itu dunia usaha, baik itu masyarakat, dan di sini juga para NGO yang ada, lokal dan luar negeri, juga teman-teman dari perguruan tinggi, bahkan dari media. Kita lakukan, kita bisa mengkoordinir, sehingga ketika terjadi bencana, kami bisa bersama-sama, seperti contoh kita kejadian di Palu, gempa bumi di Palu yang begitu dahsyat dengan tsunami, kami bisa berkolaborasi bersama-sama menanggulangi bencana melalui kluster pengungsian ini, pengungsian dan perlindungan, dan bisa berlanjut secara kontinu sampai dengan saat ini pelaksanaan kegiatan. Nah, ini mungkin di kami sudah terjadi jalinan persahabatan, jalinan networking yang sangat baik di antara semua aspek tadi dalam penanggulangan bencana, khususnya di kluster pengungsian dan perlindungan yang kami koordinir. Sehingga kami merasa terbantu sekali dengan ada teman-teman yang bergabung di kluster pengungsian dan perlindungan, baik itu dari pemerintah, baik itu dari masyarakat, dunia usaha, LSM, dari perguruan tinggi, maupun dari media dan lain sebagainya. Nah, inilah yang kami lakukan, dua pendekatan ini. Yang pertama tadi, Community Based Disaster Management yang kami lakukan melalui Tagana dan sebagainya, dan KSB, dan yang kedua kami lakukan dengan klasterisasi sehingga mereka bisa berjalan seirama di lapangan, dan syukur Alhamdulillah, walaupun Indonesia setiap hari terjadi bencana, bahkan saat ini juga saya bicara ada bencana di banjir di beberapa tempat, ya, dan ada juga gempa di beberapa tempat, kami bisa melaksanakan penanggulangan bencana semaksimal mungkin, secepat mungkin, seprofesionalnya dengan tepat guna, ya, ketepatan, dan juga kita harus melakukan koordinasi dan juga kontinuitas yang kita lakukan. Demikian sambutan kami dari Kementerian Sosial. Salam dari Ibu Menteri Sosial Republik Indonesia yang saat ini sedang bertugas di luar kota sehingga tidak bisa mengikuti kegiatan virtual meeting ini. Terima kasih. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Thank you, Mr. Ian Kusmadiana, for the remarks. So ladies and gentlemen, before we going to the next agenda, we'll have a group photo session with the keynote speakers. So once again, we would like to invite to join this group photo session, Mrs. Krista Rader, and then Mr. Pete Fogton, Mr. Ahmadul Haq, and also Mr. Dr. Andes Ian Kusmadiana, MPS-SP. Please kindly open your camera to join this group photo session. Okay, so Mrs. Krista Rader, Mr. Pete Fogton, and also Mr. Ahmadul Haq, Mr. Ian Kusmadiana, we'll take a picture, we'll take a photo group in 3, 2, 1, and please give your best smile. Okay, So please remain on your position. Please remain to open your camera. We still have another photo session, but before it, I would like to invite to join us in this photo session. The first one is representative from Tagana. Please open your camera and join this photo session. And then I also would like to invite Mr. M.D. Mahfuz Alam and also Mrs. Nigar Dilnahar. Please kindly open your camera and join this group photo session. Okay, so are you ready? We'll take a picture, we'll take a photo in 3, 2, 1, and cheers. Okay, once again, 3, 2, 1, and please give your best smile. Okay, enough. Thank you so much, Mrs. Krista Reder, Mr. Pete Fulton, Mr. Ahmadul Haq, Mr. Ian Kusmadiana, and also thank you for the representative from Tagana, Mr. Mahfuz Alam, and also Mrs. Nigar Dilnahar. Thank you so much. So ladies and gentlemen, now we will start the presentation of the first exchange learning station. Once again, I would like to remind all of you that you may post your feedback or ask questions during the session. Please post them on the Q&A box and we will discuss them at the last session on question and answer session. So ladies and gentlemen, in this session, there are two distinguished guests, distinguished speakers who will be joining us in this session. The first one is Mr. Sukamsi from Taruna Siaga Bencana or Tagana representative. The second one is Mr. Nana Suryana, also from Taruna Siaga Bencana or Tagana representative. But before listening to the presentation, we will present to you a short video about youth engagement in disaster preparedness and response in Indonesia. Enjoy the video.
Indonesia merupakan negara kepulauan terbesar di dunia dengan pesona alamnya yang memukau serta kearifan lokal di setiap wilayahnya yang memiliki daya tarik tersendiri.
Indonesia tanah air.
Kondisi geografis Indonesia yang berada pada 6 derajat lintang utara sampai dengan 11 derajat lintang selatan dan 95 derajat bujur timur sampai dengan 141 derajat bujur timur menjadikan Indonesia sebagai negara tropis yang sangat potensial di berbagai bidang, sekaligus meletakkan Indonesia sebagai negara yang berada di lingkaran cincin api atau ring of fire yang rentan terhadap berbagai bencana. Jenis bencana yang sering terjadi di Indonesia antara lain gempa bumi, erupsi gunung api, tsunami, banjir, longsor, dan angin puting beliung. Tingginya potensi bencana tersebut membuat Indonesia harus terus-menerus meningkatkan kesiapsiagaan dan mitigasi bencana. Hal ini dilakukan sebagai upaya untuk mengurangi risiko bencana dan dampak yang ditimbulkan. Edukasi bagi masyarakat yang tinggal di daerah rawan bencana merupakan agenda rutin yang terus-menerus dilakukan oleh berbagai pihak secara berkesinambungan dan sinergis, agar masyarakat memahami dan mampu melakukan upaya-upaya pengurangan risiko bencana secara mandiri. Kementerian Sosial sebagai lembaga eksekutif yang bertanggung jawab dalam pemenuhan kebutuhan dasar dan perlindungan bagi korban bencana memiliki peran sangat penting dalam upaya penanggulangan bencana di Indonesia. Selain menyediakan berbagai kebutuhan dasar dan pertolongan bagi korban bencana pada saat masa tanggap darurat bencana, sejak tahun 2004, Kementerian Sosial mulai merekrut dan melatih generasi muda dari berbagai unsur untuk menjadi relawan penanggulangan bencana yang disebut sebagai Taruna Siaga Bencana atau Tagana. Dasar pemikiran rekrutmen dan pelatihan bagi Tagana adalah memberi kesempatan bagi generasi muda untuk berpartisipasi aktif dalam penanggulangan bencana serta sebagai meningkatkan upaya pengurangan risiko bencana berbasis masyarakat. Sampai dengan saat ini, jumlah generasi muda dari 34 provinsi di Indonesia yang sudah pernah mendapat pelatihan dasar Tagana adalah sebanyak 39.044 orang. Tak cukup hanya mendapat pelatihan dasar, Tagana yang secara aktif dan proaktif melaksanakan tugasnya sebagai relawan penanggulangan bencana selalu diberi kesempatan untuk meningkatkan kapasitas dan kualitasnya dengan mengikuti berbagai jenis pelatihan dan bimbingan teknis baik yang diselenggarakan oleh Kementerian Sosial, Kementerian atau lembaga terkait, pemerintah provinsi, dan pemerintah kabupaten atau kota, maupun pelatihan dan bimbingan teknis yang diselenggarakan oleh organisasi non-pemerintah, mitra kerja, Kementerian Sosial. Dari hasil pelatihan tersebut, anggota Tagana memiliki spesialisasi atau keahlian di bidang tertentu, yaitu shelter, evakuasi, dapur umum, logistik, DVI, posko, dan layanan dukungan psikososial. Selain pelatihan dasar dan pelatihan keterampilan, anggota Tagana Indonesia juga diberi kesempatan mengikuti bimbingan teknis guna mendapatkan sertifikasi bidang pekerjaan sosial. Saat ini sudah 14.000 orang Tagana yang dinyatakan kompeten di bidang pekerjaan sosial oleh Lembaga Sertifikasi Pekerjaan Sosial Kementerian Sosial Indonesia. Selain melakukan tindakan layanan dan pertolongan di masa tanggap darurat, Tagana Indonesia aktif melakukan kegiatan-kegiatan mitigasi bencana melalui Tagana Masuk Sekolah, reboisasi, pembentukan kawasan lindung di pesisir pantai rawan tsunami dengan penanaman mangrove, pembentukan kawasan lindung di perbukitan rawan longsor dengan penanaman vetiver, pelaksanaan tugas sebagai praktisi atau instruktur dalam kegiatan pelatihan kesiapsiagaan bagi masyarakat. Posko kesiapsiagaan di tingkat kecamatan, kabupaten atau kota, provinsi, dan di Kementerian Sosial. Lebih jauh lagi, dalam kondisi normal atau tidak ada bencana, Tagana juga merintis berbagai usaha untuk pengembangan usaha ekonomi yang keuntungannya digunakan untuk membiayai kegiatan-kegiatan Tagana yang dilakukan secara swadaya dan mandiri. Pada tahun 2010, Kementerian Sosial kembali meluaskan jangkauan kesiapsiagaan dan pengurangan resiko bencana berbasis masyarakat hingga ke tingkat kecamatan dan desa atau kelurahan dengan membentuk Kampung Siaga Bencana atau KSB. Sampai dengan awal Desember 2021, telah terbentuk 799 KSB di berbagai daerah di Indonesia. Dengan kehadiran Tagana dan KSB, diharapkan dapat mewujudkan tercapainya efektivitas dalam penanggulangan dan mitigasi bencana di Indonesia.
So ladies and gentlemen, without any further ado, we would like to invite our first speaker in this session. For Mr. Sukamsi, the time is yours.
Semangat pagi, are you ready?
Yes.
Saya Sukamsi. Taruna Siaga Bencana Indonesia dari Kabupaten Kebumen, Jawa Tengah. Kami dari Tagana berada di Indonesia sadar akan keberadaan Indonesia, bahwa Indonesia dari berbagai pulau begitu indah dengan alamnya, namun di dalamnya mengandung potensi ancaman bencana. Di antaranya adalah terkenal dengan Ring of Fire, cincin api yang ada di Indonesia. Jadi disitulah Indonesia bisa dikatakan sebagai supermarket bencana. Banyak jenis bencana di Indonesia yang sering terjadi. Di antaranya ada banjir, tanah longsor, tsunami, angin topan, air bah karena faktor elevasi ada di Indonesia. Sudah selayaknya Indonesia dari Kementerian Sosial hadir menginisiasi masyarakat bagaimana membuat program pengurangan risiko bencana yang berkesinambungan dan sinergis. Semua ini harus berbasis dengan masyarakat untuk meningkatkan resiliensi dari sisi bencana dengan melakukan kegiatan pemetaan daerah rawan bencana dan melakukan kegiatan mitigasi bencana. Sudah berkali-kali dilakukan oleh teman-teman Tagana bahwa kegiatan tersebut salah satu program pengurangan risiko bencana yang menjadi andalan Kementerian Sosial melalui Tagana dan Kampung Siaga Bencana. Hadir juga di sini bahwa Kementerian Sosial dalam program pengurangan risiko bencana memiliki pilar-pilar sosial yang tadi sudah disampaikan oleh Pak Direktur Pelindungan Jaminan Sosial Bapak Ian, bahwa Kementerian Sosial punya pilar sosial di antaranya Tagana dan KSB. Ini merupakan garda terdepan Kementerian Sosial untuk andil dalam pengurangan risiko bencana. Dan kami bangga dalam hal ini karena negara mempercayakan pada kami, Tagana dan KSB, bahwa Tagana dan KSB bisa memenuhi kebutuhan dasar bagi para penyintas atau masyarakat yang terdampak. Merupakan tanggung jawab yang sangat besar bagi kami. Tapi dengan dasar-dasar yang kami lakukan adalah memiliki keunikan tersendiri. Karena apa? Tagana bisa mengikuti pelatihan atas dasar rekrutan dari Kementerian Sosial itu dari berbagai unsur keragaman yang ada di Indonesia. Jadi Tagana direkrut dari kalangan Karang Taruna, Ormas, tokoh masyarakat, tokoh adat, di situ hadir. Dari pemuda yang memiliki kemampuan ingin mengabdikan dirinya kepada negara dalam pengurangan risiko bencana, diapresiasi dengan baik oleh Kementerian Sosial. Sehingga keberagaman anggota Tagana di Indonesia dari Sabang sampai Merauke mencerminkan kebinekaan yang memperkokoh kekuatan pengurangan risiko bencana di bawah Kementerian Sosial. Tagana tidak serta-merta hadir ke lapangan, tapi harus memiliki kemampuan. Disitulah Kementerian Sosial memberikan pelatihan tentang teknisnya, cara kerjasama, multisektor. Kedua itu dirangkaikan jadi satu, sehingga kemampuan sumber daya manusia dari Tagana dan KSB di lapangan sudah tidak diragukan. Tagana diantara memiliki kemampuan atau skill dari sisi kerescuan, evakuasi, shelter, dapur umum, layanan dukungan psikososial, dan lain dan kegiatan-kegiatan lain yang di situ memang sepenuhnya dilatih oleh Kementerian Sosial dan jejaring dengan pihak lain dari komunitas SAR, dari BNPB, Basarnas, kepolisian, TNI, NGO itu sendiri hadir dalam penguatan kapasitas sebagai anggota Tagana. Anggota Tagana di lapangan mutlak menjadi garda depan. Di mana ada bencana, di situ ada Tagana. Dan terakhir, Kementerian Sosial melakukan uji kompetensi bagi anggota Tagana dan pengurus kampung siaga bencana melalui sertifikasi. Sertifikasi ini bahwa Kementerian Sosial menghadirkan SDM-nya tidak main-main. Harus betul-betul SDM yang memiliki kemampuan, kecakapan karena berkaitan dengan kebutuhan dasar manusia. Jadi sekali lagi, kami merasa bangga menjadi Tagana Indonesia dan KSB. Semoga Kementerian Sosial beserta garda depan pilar-pilar Tagana dan KSB tetap tangguh menciptakan masyarakat yang kuat dan selalu siap siaga. Disitulah bisa kami bergerak dengan serius, dengan bekerja sama semua pihak. Terima kasih.
Thank you, Mr. Sukamsi, for the presentation. Once again, on behalf of everyone here, I would like to thank you for your interesting presentation. So, ladies and gentlemen, moving along to our next agenda is a presentation that will be delivered by Mr. Nana Suryana. The time is yours.
Baik, terima kasih. Semangat pagi, are you ready? Perkenalkan, nama saya Nana Suryana. Saya anggota Tagana Indonesia dari Kabupaten Pangandaran, Provinsi Jawa Barat. Bapak-Ibu yang saya hormati, dalam kesempatan ini, saya ingin menjelaskan kegiatan Tagana di fase kesiapsiagaan seperti yang sudah Bapak-Ibu saksikan dalam video tayangan tadi. Dalam fase kesiapsiagaan ini, Tagana memiliki beberapa kegiatan yang perannya cukup penting dalam penanggulangan bencana di Indonesia. Salah satu kegiatan kita yaitu Tagana Masuk Sekolah atau kita singkat TMS. Program ini merupakan sarana edukasi bencana yang ditujukan untuk para pelajar, guru, dan masyarakat lingkungan sekitar sekolah. Di mana kami mendatangi sekolah-sekolah untuk memberikan pemahaman tentang kebencanaan. Kegiatan ini bertujuan agar mereka lebih siap dan waspada terhadap kemungkinan adanya ancaman bencana yang terjadi di wilayah mereka. Materi yang diberikan dalam kegiatan TMS ini disesuaikan dengan potensi ancaman bencana di wilayah mereka masing-masing. Dengan program tersebut, diharapkan mereka memahami pengetahuan tentang bencana, mengetahui potensi dan ancaman bencana, sehingga mereka mampu melakukan upaya-upaya pengurangan risiko bencana dan melakukan penyelamatan diri. Tagana Masuk Sekolah sendiri dilaksanakan secara terus-menerus, berkelanjutan dari jenjang usia dini hingga ke tingkat perguruan tinggi. Selain itu, program lainnya yaitu Nelayan Siaga Bencana. Kami menyadari bahwa Indonesia merupakan daerah yang memiliki potensi gempa megatrust yang cukup besar. Sehingga kami harus selalu siaga dan waspada. Karena itu, kami juga menyiapkan jejaring relawan berbasis masyarakat di pesisir. Kami membentuk nelayan siaga bencana. Salah satu pilot proyek kami yaitu di Kabupaten Pangandaran. Kami melatih para nelayan untuk ikut berperan aktif dalam upaya mitigasi dan penanggulangan bencana. Kami juga melakukan kegiatan-kegiatan mitigasi lainnya, seperti program Tagana Menjaga Alam, yaitu melakukan penanaman pohon di wilayah berisiko bencana, seperti daerah-daerah pegunungan, rawan longsor yang dan pantai-pantai di pesisir selatan yang rawan tsunami. Salah satu kegiatan yang masif kita lakukan saat ini yaitu penanaman mangrove. Kami bertekad untuk menciptakan hutan-hutan mangrove, membangun green belt untuk melindungi masyarakat pesisir dari ancaman bencana tsunami dan abrasi. Selama ini, upaya-upaya tersebut telah signifikan memberikan dampak positif bagi lingkungan dan masyarakat yang hidup di pesisir pantai. Mangrove yang kami tanam juga mampu menghidupkan ekosistem di muara, sehingga memberikan nilai ekonomi yang bisa dimanfaatkan oleh masyarakat. Ikan, kepiting, dan biota laut lainnya semakin banyak sehingga memiliki nilai ekonomi yang sangat tinggi dan bisa dimanfaatkan oleh masyarakat sekitar. Keberadaan hutan mangrove ini juga menjadi destinasi wisata, sehingga memiliki peran yang sangat penting bagi kelangsungan ekonomi masyarakat pesisir. Kami bertekad untuk terus menghijaukan kawasan pegunungan dan kawasan pantai yang rawan bencana. Selain itu, kami juga terus melakukan edukasi, memberikan pemahaman kebencanaan kepada masyarakat, termasuk menjadi fasilitator dalam pembentukan kampung siaga bencana. KSB ini sebagai wadah penanggulangan bencana berbasis masyarakat. Kami merekrut potensi-potensi sumber daya yang ada di desa. Para pemuda kami rangkul, tokoh masyarakat, tokoh agama, dan kelompok-kelompok masyarakat lainnya untuk sama-sama berperan aktif dalam penanggulangan bencana di Indonesia. Mereka dilatih bagaimana menangani bencana, mulai dari evakuasi, pendirian shelter, dapur umum, sampai manajemen penanganan logistik dengan mendirikan gardu sosial dan lumbung-lumbung sosial. Dengan adanya kampung siaga bencana ini, penanganan bencana di tingkat desa bisa lebih terorganisir, lebih cepat, serta adanya peran aktif masyarakat dengan kearifan lokalnya. Masyarakat yang dilatih kemampuannya menjadi relawan KSB ini, saat ini menjadi garda terdepan bersama-sama dengan kami, Taruna Siaga Indonesia, dalam membantu penanganan bencana. Kami sangat bangga bisa hadir membantu masyarakat, membantu negara dalam penanganan bencana. Terima kasih, terima kasih.
Thank you, Mr. Nana Suryana, for the presentation. And before we going to the next presentation in this first session, ladies and gentlemen, we'll present to you a short video about youth engagement in disaster preparedness and response in Bangladesh. Enjoy the video.
WFP-র সহায়তায় আমরা অনেকগুলো ট্রেনিং পেয়েছি এই দুর্যোগের উপরে। ট্রেনিং পাওয়ার পরে প্রথমে আমরা আমাদের ইউনিয়ন পরিষদের যে কমিটিটা গঠন করি, এই কমিটিতে আমরা ইউনিয়ন পরিষদের সকল সম্প্রদায়ের লোককে নিয়ে এখানে আমরা কমিটিটা গঠন করি এবং এখানে নারীদের এই কমিটির ভিতরে আমরা রাখি।
হাতরা প্রকল্প থেকে সিআরএ ট্রেনিং পাইছি এবং ফার্স্ট এইড, সার্চ অ্যান্ড রেস্কিউ বিষয়ে প্রশিক্ষণ পাইছি। পারিবারিক পর্যায়ে উপকারভোগী মহিলাদের দুর্যোগ বিষয়ে প্রশিক্ষণ পাইছি এবং আমি ওনাদেরকে প্রশিক্ষণ দিয়েছি।
যখন সিগনাল ওঠে তখন আমি রাস্তাঘাট, বাজার সংলগ্ন এলাকায় মাইকিং করি। যে সমস্ত বৃদ্ধা আছে বা প্রতিবন্ধী আছে এগুলোকে সংকেত বাড়ার সঙ্গে সঙ্গেই তাদেরকে বলি যে সাইক্লোন শেল্টারে আসবেন আপনারা।
এই যে রাস্তাটা হয়, এই রাস্তাটা আগে ছিল না, যখন ছিল না তখন আমাদের এই যে উচ্চ জোয়ারের যে পানি যেটা আসতো সেটা এটা ভিতরে চলে আসতো এবং প্লাবিত হয়ে যেত। 6 নম্বর কয়রা এবং 5 নম্বর কয়রার সেতু বন্ধন হয়ে গেছে এই রাস্তাটার মাধ্যমে।
এখানে কিন্তু প্রতিনিয়ত দুর্যোগের শিকার আমাদের হতে হয়। যদি আমরা ধরি জনপদের দিক থেকে সর্বশেষ অবস্থান আর দুর্যোগের দিক থেকে প্রথম অবস্থান, পানির যে আধার যেগুলো সেগুলো বিপর্যস্ত হয়ে যায়, সম্পূর্ণ পানির নিচে তলিয়ে যায়।
ফকফরে এলাকায় জলবদ্ধতা হয় না, ঠিকমতো পানি নিষ্কাশন নাই এবং এলাকায় সুন্দর ফসল আছে এবং দুই পাশে রাস্তায় এই জনপদটা আরও এখন উন্নতি হয়েছে।
People who lived through fear from natural disasters all throughout the years now are stronger than before because they now know how to fight back.
সচেতন না হলে পরে,
সচেতন না হলে পরে,
সচেতন না হলে পরে হারাবো সজন,
সময় থাকতে হবো সচেতন,
যদি আর হবে না মরণ শুনির জনগণ, সময় থাকতে হবো সচেতন।
দুর্যোগ মোকাবেলায় ভাইরে আছে হাতিয়ার, আছে স্ট্যান্ডিং অর্ডার অন ডিজাস্টার, ব্যবস্থাপনা আইন মানবো যে সবাই, সবার আগে নীতিমালা জানতে হবে ভাই। ঘূর্ণিঝড় জলোচ্ছ্বাস কাল বৈশাখী শুরুর পূর্বে বাঁধ অবদার দুই ধারেতে গাছ লাগাতে হবে, ঘরের পোতা উঁচু করে বেঁধে নিব ভাই, গবাদি পশু হাঁস মুরগির ঘর মজবুত রাখা চাই। নিয়মিত আবহাওয়ার খবর শুনবো সবে, ঘরের টানা বাঁধন শক্ত করে নিতে হবে, গ্রামের সকল জনগোষ্ঠীর ঝুঁকি নিরূপণ, সকল পেশার মানুষ করবে অংশগ্রহণ, মিলেমিশে করব ঝুঁকি হ্রাস পরিকল্পনা, এ বিষয়টি প্রশিক্ষণে সবার হবে জানা, ঝুঁকি হ্রাস পরিকল্পনা হবে প্রণয়ন, জিওএনজিও সবাই মিলে করব বাস্তবায়ন, বিপদে আপদে সবাই,
বিপদে আপদে সবাই,
বিপদে আপদে সবাই সবার আপন।
So ladies and gentlemen, now I'm delighted to invite the next speakers from Bangladesh, Head of Sub-Office BDKSO, to deliver his presentation. For Mr. MD Mahfuz Alam, the time is yours.
Dear distinguished participants, good morning. I'd like to welcome you all in the session today to exchange of learning on emergency preparedness and disaster risk reduction in order to build better disaster management, programming and capacity of Bangladesh and Indonesia under the banner of South-South and Triangular Cooperation. My name is Mahfuz Alam. I am working for World Food Program in Bangladesh as Head of Sub-Office in Southwestern Region. I am greatly honored to have this opportunity to share you the scenario of southern coastal area as well as youth-led disaster risk reduction initiatives in Bangladesh. Bangladesh is among the most disaster-prone countries of the world. The country is frequently hit by various natural disasters. Southern coastal belt is vulnerable to cyclones and associated storm surges and floods because of its location, sea level geography, of its 580 kilometers exposed coastline and high population density. The vulnerability of a large section of poor and socially disadvantaged groups of people to natural hazards poses a serious challenge to development. In a multi-disaster prone country with a high population density, practically no natural hazard occurs without adversely affecting a large number of people and their assets. However, during the past 20 years, Bangladesh has managed to reduce deaths and injuries from cyclones. The main factors responsible for these reduced fatalities and injuries are improved defensive measures, including modernizing early warning systems, developing evacuation plans to shelter, and constructing coastal embankments and raising awareness at the community level. The key success factor in minimizing cyclone-related mortality is increasing community-level cyclone preparedness involving youth volunteers under the Cyclone Preparedness Program, CPP, of Bangladesh government. The Cyclone Preparedness Program is a unique institutional arrangement for community preparedness created to mitigate the challenges of catastrophic cyclones. CPP has been operational by the youth volunteer engagement in the field. CPP volunteers disseminate cyclone warning signals issued by the Bangladesh Meteorological Department, provide and assist in first aid, rescue, relief, and rehabilitation operations, and contributing and building community capacity, disaster management, and development activities. These youth volunteers are local inhabitants with different occupations, but these volunteers remain active during the cyclone seasons for any immediate involvement. This volunteerism program contributed strongly in holistic women empowerment. Women volunteers' active engagement increases the gender parity in disaster risk management. Their functional and leadership role ensure the protection of most vulnerable people like elderly, pregnant and lactating mother, persons with disabilities. The women death toll declined due to increased access to early warning information and life-saving services through CPP, women volunteer, is an incredible achievement. There are many role model women in the community who became the example of women leadership for their community. WP Bangladesh implemented a project in southwestern coastal areas to strengthen gender equitable ability of people, households, communities, and systems to mitigate, adapt, and recover from natural shocks and stresses. The project especially targeted youths to facilitate and community resilience by developing their capacity and knowledge. WP efforts on disaster risk reduction and management at the sub-national levels, including supporting women to take a proactive role in disaster management. WP's formal agreement with Bangladesh government's Cyclone Preparedness Program, CPP, positively contributes implementation of disaster risk reduction activities with the support of 2,000 selected youth volunteers with equal representation of male and female. WP organized intensive trainings on disaster preparedness and risk reduction for the youth volunteers, including skill-based trainings on participatory rapid appraisal, community risk assessment, risk reduction action plan, and comprehensive disaster management plan. Preparation process that enhance their knowledge and skills. After the trainings, WP linked the volunteers with the disaster management committees at the local level and engaged the volunteers in community risk assessment process to develop risk reduction action plan. Also conducted household level orientations on disaster preparedness and risk reduction in the face of cyclone. The awareness raising campaign through mock drill, stage drama, and folk songs. WP also provided training to the selected youth volunteers on a script to perform a cyclone simulation exercise. After the training, WP has been organized cyclone simulation exercises with the support of local community people, where a group of youth volunteers from the same community perform on a fixed script and audio for wider community awareness. Distinguished participants, it's time to bring this sharing to a close. I sincerely appreciate for your attention that I have had this opportunity to present to you. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Mahfuz Alam. I'd like to express our appreciation of your most insightful presentation. And once again, thank you to all speakers in this first session, Mr. Sukamsi, Mr. Nana Suryana, and also Mr. Mahfuz Alam for a most delightful presentation in this session. So ladies and gentlemen, we're going to our next agenda is question and answer session. So let me read some questions that has been collected by the committee. We have several feedback and question here. So the first question from one of our participants is about, does MOSA have a particular strategy for Tagana regeneration? Maybe I'd like to invite Mr. Sukamsi or Mr. Nana Suryana to answer the question. So once again, please, for Mr. Nana or Mr. Sukamsi to answer the question, please open your camera. Yeah, Mr. Sukamsi, does MOSA have a particular strategy for Tagana regeneration?
Terima kasih. Pertanyaan yang baik. Jadi berkaitan dengan sertifikasi, semua relawan SDM Tagana dan KSB resmi mendapat. Itu bahwa kecakapan dibuktikan dengan sertifikat yang dikeluarkan oleh LSB. Alhamdulillah cukup banyak untuk Tagana Indonesia dan KSB yang sudah lolos melalui uji kompetensi oleh Kementerian Sosial. Itu merupakan kekuatan bagi teman-teman Tagana dan KSB bahwa kepercayaan dirinya untuk bisa melakukan kegiatan penanggulangan bencana, mereka itu merasa optimis dan yakin bahwa apa yang dilakukan sudah memenuhi standar yang ditentukan oleh Kementerian Sosial berkaitan dengan upaya penanggulangan bencana. Itu bisa yang kami jawab.
Oke, thank you Mr. Sukamsi for answer the question. And maybe for Mr. Mahfuz Alam, what about Bangladesh? Does Bangladesh have a particular strategy for regeneration?
Thank you. Basically, Bangladesh government works for the cyclone affected people. Basically, the early warning system that is emphasized first. So CPP, the Cyclone Preparedness Program, they are basically key persons to work at the field, at the front line. So the 76,000 CPP volunteers, they are involved for this, and they are actively involved, I should say, for early warning system as well as to support for early recovery and during disaster as well. Yeah. So the thing is like, there is a very good initiative. I think the government persons like Mr. Ahmadul Haq and Mr. Mohsin, they are also present here. I think they can even explain like how Bangladesh government basically support here. So from WP side, we do provide training. Basically, we provided training to the CPP volunteers. About 2,000 volunteers, we provided trainings on different issues, like so that they can even perform better. Yeah.
Okay, thank you, Mr. Mahfuz Alam. So maybe for the next question, still with Mr. Mahfuz Alam, how does Bangladesh can maintain such a big number of members?
Basically, they are the volunteers from the locality. They are the inhabitant of that areas. There is a very good setup from Cyclone Preparedness Program. And the government officials, they're also, they time to time provide them training, and they're also coordinating with the volunteers at the field. And volunteers also, they're communicating with their leadership and on regular basis. And time to time, they also organize meeting of the volunteers. And when the cyclone approached to hit, so at that time, basically, the volunteers come together, they sit together, and what they should do, and they are guided by the government people and other government directors, and they have unit leaders, they have union leaders, and they all basically coordinate together, and accordingly, they basically started work over there for this. They do early warning system, and they operate it accordingly.
Okay, thank you, Mr. Mahfuz. Same question for Mr. Sukamsi. How does MOSA maintain such a big number of Tagana or voluntary personnel? Does it have particular information system management, Mr. Sukamsi?
Terima kasih. Untuk Tagana ada di Indonesia beberapa untuk mengelola informasi, yaitu bentuknya dengan aplikasi. Yang di sini di Indonesia itu melalui SIMTAG, ada SIMBA, ada aplikasi-aplikasi lain yang berkaitan dengan ketaganaan. Masuk juga pengelolaan supaya organisasinya bisa koordinasinya supaya lebih baik. Ada juga didukung dari namanya Forum Komunikasi Taganaan dari tingkatan kabupaten, provinsi sampai ke pusat. Didukung juga ada satu wadah yang difasilitasi dan juga didukung atas peranan pemerintah Kementerian Sosial melalui WhatsApp grup yang di situ dipantau semua berkaitan gerakan relawan Tagana di Indonesia. Jadi teman-teman Tagana dari Sabang sampai Merauke yang jumlahnya ribuan itu bisa terpantau jelas bagaimana cara mengkomunikasikan yang baik. Di sisi lain, keterlibatan dari media pun hadir untuk ikut serta bagaimana memberikan informasi keberadaan Tagana di Indonesia, baik dalam keadaan pra-bencana, saat bencana, dan juga pasca bencana. Ini bentuk-bentuk yang selama ini bisa dirasakan oleh teman-teman Tagana sehingga menjadi Tagana itu kompak. Itu yang bisa kami jelaskan.
Okay, thank you, Mr. Sukamsi, to explain how Tagana can maintain a lot of members, a lot of participant. Kita berbicara dari Sabang sampai Merauke. Thank you, Mr. Sukamsi, for answer the question, and also thank you, Mr. Mahfuz Alam, to answer the question. So this is the end of question and answer session. Thank you so much for all speakers, Mr. Nana, Mr. Sukamsi, and also Mr. Mahfuz Alam. Once again, thank you so much for very delightful discussion in this session. So now we will start the presentation and discussion session of the second exchange learning session. So ladies and gentlemen, we have three distinguished speakers as Tagana representatives who will be joining us in this session. The first one is Mrs. Ferida, the second one is Mr. Nana Suryana, and the last speaker is Mr. Sukamsi. But before we listen to their presentation, we will present to you a short video about youth engagement in disaster preparedness and response in Indonesia. Enjoy the video.
A anggota Tagana yang tersebar sampai ke pelosok pedesaan membuat respon penanganan bencana dapat lebih cepat dilakukan. Saat ada kejadian di satu wilayah tertentu, anggota Tagana setempat segera bertindak cepat, berkoordinasi dengan pihak-pihak terkait, saling bahu-membahu untuk melakukan penanganan bencana. Semangat pengabdian serta jiwa kerelawanan yang ditanamkan pada setiap anggota Tagana telah menjadi kekuatan kelompok relawan ini untuk melakukan tindakan cepat, tanggap, dan sigap di setiap kejadian bencana.
Tagana ini ada penjenjangan, Tagana Muda, terus Tagana Madya, dan Tagana Utama. Tagana Muda ini sebagai pelaksananya. Terus nanti setelah mereka beberapa bulan melalui seleksi, itu ada penjenjangan menjadi Tagana Madya. Tagana Utama ini harus mampu menjadi wakil Kementerian Sosial. Walaupun kita binaan atau relawan mitra dari Kementerian Sosial, tapi kita membawa misi atau pekerjaan dari Kementerian Sosial itu sendiri.
Selain pelatihan dan bimbingan teknis, Kementerian Sosial dan pemerintah daerah melalui Dinas Sosial juga menyediakan berbagai fasilitas pendukung penanggulangan bencana seperti seragam dan peralatan yang diberikan baik kepada individu maupun kepada kelompok atau forum Tagana di tingkat provinsi dan kabupaten atau kota. Tagana hadir untuk membantu pemerintah dalam upaya melindungi masyarakat dari kejadian bencana, baik pada saat pra-bencana, tanggap darurat bencana, maupun pasca-bencana. Tagana juga memiliki peran aktif dalam penanganan permasalahan sosial lainnya. Tagana menjadi cermin partisipasi masyarakat dalam upaya penanggulangan bencana di Indonesia. Tagana terbuka bagi semua unsur dan semua pihak dalam masyarakat untuk berkolaborasi, bersinergi, dan bahu-membahu dalam upaya penanggulangan bencana. Karenanya, selain kerjasama langsung dengan banyak pihak atau sesama relawan di lokasi kejadian bencana, ada komunitas-komunitas yang disebut sebagai sahabat Tagana, antara lain dari komunitas jurnalis. Dalam Tagana, perempuan mendapat tempat dan kedudukan yang sama dengan laki-laki untuk memberikan kontribusi dalam upaya penanggulangan bencana. Anggota Tagana yang perempuan tidak hanya berperan di dapur umum ataupun layanan dukungan psikososial, tetapi juga mampu berperan sebagai anggota tim penyelamatan atau rescue.
Pas di saat saya nggak diperbolehkan untuk ikut menolong, saya mempunyai satu pertanyaan, apa perbedaan perempuan sama laki-laki gitu. Mungkin dari dia bilang perempuan itu nggak pantas, perempuan itu pantasnya di dapur aja, kamu bagian dapur. Tapi saya jawab, saya dapur bisa. Dari awal saya ikut relawan, saya itu tertariknya di rescue. Jadi karena pengalaman saya yang sering melihat korban-korban yang kurang tanggap cepat penolongannya itu lambat, itu yang membuat tekad saya. Jadi saya pernah membuktikan, saya praktekkan sama orang itu cara penolongannya, cara gimana langsung terjunnya gitu. Dan alhasilnya dia mulai percaya dari sedikit praktek-praktek yang saya buktikan.
Selama hampir 2 tahun terakhir, pandemi COVID-19 telah menimbulkan dampak yang sangat berat terhadap kehidupan masyarakat di hampir seluruh negara di dunia, termasuk Indonesia.
Yang mana pada waktu COVID kemarin masih cukup meledak itu, semua kawan-kawan Tagana buka dapur umum dalam rangka untuk mensupport satu, para nakes, yang kedua adalah masyarakat relawan, yang ketiga adalah para mereka yang lagi isoman.
Meski Indonesia rawan terhadap berbagai bencana, tetapi Kementerian Sosial bersama Tagana dan KSB meyakini bahwa ada beberapa jenis bencana yang dapat dicegah atau diminimalisir risiko maupun dampaknya, antara lain banjir, longsor, dan gelombang pasang.
Kaitan dengan pola tanam, kami tidak asal menanam pola itu tidak, tapi pakai pola. Polanya bagaimana? Menanam itu harus punya strategis untuk apa tujuannya. Tujuannya selain untuk green belt, sabuk hijau dalam upaya mitigasi, di sini kita harus pola menanam. Pola menanam itu tujuannya untuk sirkulasi angin, Terus untuk rencana ke depan menjadi edukasi winat khusus dengan cara untuk sebagai alur perahu pengunjung, pakai kano atau pakai perahu pesiar. Ada juga untuk kita saat operasi menggunakan alat tangkap, itu harus pakai pola.
Kawasan pantai yang bersih dan indah bahkan dapat dijadikan sebagai kawasan wisata yang tidak hanya bertujuan untuk melestarikan lingkungan. Namun, sekaligus sebagai sumber dana mandiri untuk kegiatan-kegiatan Tagana dan KSB. Kami bangga menjadi anggota Tagana dan KSB, karena dalam banyak situasi tenang, ketika tidak ada bencana, kami bisa bertemu, bertukar pengalaman, bertukar ilmu, dan saling menguatkan satu sama lain. Kami bangga menjadi anggota Tagana dan KSB, karena kami mempunyai kesempatan dan ruang untuk berbakti kepada bangsa dan negara kami melalui kegiatan penanggulangan bencana dan pemberian pertolongan bagi korban bencana. Kami bangga menjadi anggota Tagana dan KSB karena melalui bakti kami, ada banyak warga masyarakat dan korban bencana yang bisa tertolong, berkurang kesedihannya, dan bisa tersenyum kembali. Meski wajah kami kemudian terlupakan, meski nama kami tidak dikenali dan tidak diingat, kami bangga menjadi anggota Tagana dan KSB untuk Indonesiaku yang tumbuh dan tangguh.
So ladies and gentlemen, without any further ado, we would like to invite our first speaker in this second session. For Mrs. Ferida, the time is yours.
Semangat pagi, 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 pagi. Perkenalkan, nama saya Ferida, saya berasal dari Provinsi Jawa Timur. Saya sudah bergabung dengan Tagana sejak tahun 2004. Dalam sesi pagi ini, perkenalkan saya untuk berbagi pengalaman mengenai tanggap darurat erupsi Gunung Semeru di Gunung Semeru di Kabupaten Lumajang, Provinsi Jawa Timur. Peran Tagana perempuan sangat penting. Peran Tagana perempuan di dalam tanggap darurat sangat penting, bukan hanya sekedar membantu operasional kegiatan di lapangan, tetapi juga ikut andil dalam merencanakan program kegiatan penanggulangan bencana. Contohnya dalam konteks perlindungan khusus perempuan, anak-anak, dan lanjut usia. Tagana juga berperan aktif dalam melaksanakan pemenuhan kebutuhan dalam bentuk dapur kreasi dengan melibatkan masyarakat dalam pelaksanaan program tersebut, seperti membuat kue olahan, produk kerajinan, dalam rangka mendukung program pemulihan pasca bencana. Di dalam pelaksanaan kegiatan, Tagana berkolaborasi dengan multi pihak, seperti lembaga pemerintah terkait, dunia usaha, serta masyarakat terdampak. Tagana juga berperan aktif dalam mendukung program Kampung Siaga Bencana untuk meningkatkan resiliensi masyarakat. Kegiatan yang dilakukan oleh Tagana dan KSB seperti mendirikan posko kesehatan yang bekerja sama dengan Palang Merah Indonesia, mendirikan fasilitas taman bermain anak-anak, tempat ibadah yang layak, serta fasilitas air bersih dan sanitasi. Saat ini kita masih di dalam masa pandemi COVID-19. Tagana berperan aktif dalam memutus rantai penyebaran virus COVID tersebut dengan melakukan beberapa kegiatan seperti penyemprotan desinfektan di fasilitas umum, tempat ibadah, pemukiman warga, sekolah, pasar, dan kantor pemerintahan. Program peningkatan gizi untuk para pasien COVID, tenaga medis, agar membantu peningkatan imunitas dalam bentuk distribusi makanan bergizi sebanyak rata-rata 7.000 paket per hari. Demikian beberapa pengalaman yang bisa saya sampaikan dari kegiatan saya sebagai Tagana di Provinsi Jawa Timur. Saya bangga menjadi seorang Tagana yang mewakili kaum perempuan, di mana saya dengan keterbatasan bisa mengabdi kepada masyarakat dan negara dalam bentuk keahlian, pikiran, dan tenaga yang bermanfaat bagi kemanusiaan. Terima kasih Kementerian Sosial Republik Indonesia yang telah memberikan kesempatan untuk saya mengabdi kepada nusa dan bangsa. Are you ready? Yes! Terima kasih.
Thank you, Mrs. Farida, for your presentation. It shows how women can take a significant part of this organization, Tagana. So, ladies and gentlemen, going to the next presentation that will be delivered by our next speakers. So, I would like to invite Mr. Nana Suryana to deliver his presentation. The time is yours.
Baik, terima kasih. Di sesi kedua ini kita akan membahas tentang peran Tagana dalam penanggulangan bencana. Dalam melaksanakan tugasnya, Tagana berperan dalam tiga fase, yaitu pada saat prabencana, pada saat bencana terjadi, dan pada saat pasca bencana. Pada saat prabencana, kita melakukan berbagai kegiatan-kegiatan dalam upaya pengurangan risiko bencana. Salah satunya yaitu dengan pendataan dan pemetaan daerah-daerah yang rawan bencana. Kami membuat peta jalur evakuasi, membuat roadmap, serta direktori untuk mendata potensi-potensi yang ada di masyarakat. Kemudian kegiatan kami juga melakukan peningkatan kapasitas, baik kami secara kelembagaan maupun masyarakat dalam usaha untuk pengurangan risiko bencana. Kami melaksanakan kegiatan pelatihan secara rutin dalam penanganan bencana. Kemudian, kita juga melakukan peningkatan kesiapsiagaan bersama masyarakat. Kita melatih diri untuk melakukan kesiapsiagaan dalam menghadapi bencana. Kita rutin dalam mengadakan simulasi bencana, disesuaikan dengan potensi dan ancaman bencana di wilayah masing-masing daerah. Kami juga membangun sistem deteksi dini, sistem peringatan dini dengan berbasis kearifan lokal. Itulah kegiatan Tagana pada saat pra-bencana. Kami tidak diam, kami terus bergerak. Kemudian pada saat bencana, kita melakukan kegiatan assessment atau melakukan kaji cepat di lapangan. Kami bergerak cepat mendata korban bencana serta melaporkannya kepada Kementerian Sosial serta pihak-pihak terkait. Sehingga penanganan bencana akan lebih cepat. Kemudian di pasca bencana, kita juga turun ke lapangan untuk melakukan identifikasi dan mendata kerugian serta kerusakan akibat dampak bencana. Kita bergotong royong bersama pemerintah, lembaga swasta, serta masyarakat untuk sama-sama melakukan kegiatan pemulihan, termasuk juga pendampingan sosial. Dalam melaksanakan tugas di lapangan, kita juga selalu bersinergi dengan berbagai pihak, menjalin sinergitas dengan semua instansi dan komunitas yang terkait, baik itu pada saat pra-bencana, pada saat bencana, maupun pada saat pasca bencana. Sehingga upaya-upaya penanganan bencana ini dilaksanakan secara terarah dan terorganisir dengan sangat baik. Kami tentunya sangat berterima kasih sekali kepada Kementerian Sosial, Dinas Sosial di daerah yang sudah memfasilitasi kami dan membantu kami dalam melaksanakan tugas kemanusiaan. Kami saling melengkapi, Tagana bergerak di lapangan dengan keahliannya dalam penanganan bencana, sementara pemerintah melalui Kementerian Sosial dan Dinas Sosial memfasilitasi kami dalam melaksanakan tugas, serta memastikan semua kebutuhan dasar masyarakat terdampak memenuhi, terpenuhi. Terima kasih Kementerian Sosial, kami sangat bangga menjadi bagian dari petugas penanggulangan bencana Indonesia. Terima kasih.
Thank you, Mr. Nana, for your presentation. It shows how Tagana take part of the disaster risk management and always build a synergy. So, ladies and gentlemen, before we going to the next presentation, we would like to invite in this session the last speakers from Tagana representative, Mr. Sukamsi. The time is yours.
Terima kasih. Kita bertemu kembali pada season 2 ini. Di sini kami melanjutkan bahwa di video yang kedua, apa sih peran yang sudah dibuktikan oleh teman-teman Tagana Indonesia dalam upaya mitigasi? Kami akan bercerita di daerah saya sendiri, Kabupaten Kebumen. Bentuk mitigasi nyata yang sudah bisa dinikmati adalah perwujudan hutan untuk green belt atau sabuk hijau. Jadi mangrove yang sudah tercipta sekarang kisaran dari 57 kilo pantai Kebumen, diantaranya ada 7 titik dan ada 1 titik yang hampir 85 hektar sudah tertanami, dan paling membanggakan adalah rubahnya status kelas lahan. Yang dulunya lahan itu lahan masih tersengketa, sekarang menjadi lahan yang tidak disengketakan karena rubah statusnya menjadi kawasan hutan lindung melalui negara hadir menciptakan kawasan ekosistem esensial. Disitulah kami merasa bangga bahwa di kabupaten yang belum ada sejarah mangrove, sekarang ada mangrove di Kabupaten Kebumen. Program pelestarian lingkungan yang kami lakukan tidak lepas adalah melibatkan komunitas masyarakat. Masyarakat hadir di situ untuk betul-betul kita rekrut, kita arahkan bagaimana peran masyarakat dalam upaya perwujudan hutan yang tujuannya adalah untuk mitigasi, ekonomi, ekologi, edukasi, dan sampai ke tingkat pengurangan wabah pandemi yang selama ini dirasakan. Dan satu lagi keuntungan adalah intrusi air laut. Dengan mangrove yang besar, saya yakin intrusi yang dan elevasi air laut bisa dirasakan oleh masyarakat yang dulunya asin sekarang bisa tawar di kawasan sekitaran pantai. Di sini kami, Tagana juga memiliki jenjang Tagana, Tagana Muda Maja Utama. Perlu kami jelaskan juga sedikit besarnya bahwa Tagana Muda itu di bagian apa dalam melakukannya, itu Tagana Muda di bagian teknis. Maja itu di bagian apa? Bagian memimpin leadership, kepemimpinan di lapangan. Utama hadir itu sebagai tangan menteri yang bisa bertanggung jawab di wilayah apabila terjadi apa-apa. Kegiatan dari Tagana, dari Muda Maja, ini juga diuji melalui media yang disediakan oleh Kementerian Sosial. Melalui kegiatan apa? Temu Tagana secara nasional, yaitu Jambore. Di situ diadu kecakapan. Jadi negara memberikan apresi bagi wilayah atau provinsi, perwakilan provinsi di Indonesia itu bagi yang berprestasi diberikan sebuah reward tersendiri oleh pemerintah. Nah, ada juga di sini kegiatan-kegiatan peningkatan Tagana melalui podcast, juga melakukan kegiatan webinar dan konsultasi secara pribadi dengan peran-peran NGO yang selama ini hadir. Itu yang membuat kami menjadi bangga menjadi Tagana. Terima kasih. Siapa kita? Tagana Indonesia siap.
Thank Thank you, Mr. Sukamsi, for the presentation, one of Tagana program for environmental conservation. So ladies and gentlemen, following next, we will hear the presentation from Bangladesh. But before we continue the presentation, we will present to you a short video about youth engagement in disaster preparedness and response in Bangladesh. Enjoy the video.
বাড়লে আমাদের চলাচল কষ্ট হয়, ঘরে থাকা কষ্ট হয়, জিনিসপত্রের কষ্ট হয়, মনে করেন গরু ছাগলের কষ্ট হয়, হাঁস মুরগি রাখার কষ্ট হয়, আবার পানি টিউবওয়েল তলায় গেছে, টিউবওয়েলের পানির বিশুদ্ধ পানি পাই না,
ঘরে খাওয়া হয় না, ঘর সংসার পানি পাইছে, সংসার তলা তলার ভাব হয়েছে, ঢোকা যায় না, ঘরে ভিতরে ঢোকা পানি না দেখে নৌকা থাকি শুয়ে রাত্রিতে।
আসলে আমরা আঙ্গুর কামলে বিচা খাই, পানি এসে গেল, এখন টেহা পাইছি, টেহা দা চাইল আনছি, আলু আনছি, ডাল আনছি, নল লবল মরিচ আনছি, কোলাহানের খাবার দাবার আনছি।
পূর্ববর্তী সময়ে আমি যাত্রাপুর ইউনিয়ন পরিষদের তথ্য সেবা কেন্দ্র থেকে বিভিন্ন পূর্বাভাস ভিত্তিক তথ্য সংগ্রহ করি এবং স্থানীয় ভাষায় সেটার রূপান্তর করে পাড়ায় পাড়ায় মহল্লায় মহল্লায় মাইকিংয়ের মাধ্যমে প্রচার করি। ফ্ল্যাট মার্কারগুলোতে থাকা তিনটা দাগ আছে, সবুজ দাগ, হলুদ দাগ এবং লাল দাগ। এই তিনটা দাগের যে সংকেতগুলো আছে এগুলো আমি বুঝাই দেই, যে সবুজ দাগে আসলে তারা নিশ্চিন্তে থাকতে পারে, হলুদ দাগে আসলে তারা যেন সতর্ক হয় এবং লাল দাগে আসলে তারা যেন আশ্রয় কেন্দ্রে অবস্থান করে। আর বন্যার পরবর্তী সময়ে যখন পানি শুকিয়ে যায় তখন তারা আশ্রয় কেন্দ্র থেকে বাড়ি ফিরতে আমরা তাদেরকে সাহায্য করি এবং তাদের বাড়িঘরগুলো বন্যায় যে ভেঙে যায় বা নষ্ট হয়ে যায় আমরা সেগুলো পুনর্গঠনে সহায়তা করি।
Thank you. আমরা শুনতেছি যে মাইকিনে বলতেছে যে পানি আসবে তাহলে এখন আমরা কি কি করব
শুকনা খড়ি আবার চুলা আবার ভাতের পাল্লা ভাতের পাল্লা আবার কড়াই এই যে পানির ঠিলা এনে নিয়ে পোলাও করে বই খাতা কলম এনে পুস্তক নিয়ে আমরা ঘুরাই করে আর কি শুকনা জায়গায় আমরা চলে যাব
একটি জরুরি ঘোষণা খবর পাওয়া যাচ্ছে উজানে নুনখাওয়া পয়েন্টে ব্রহ্মপুত্র নদের পানি তিন দিনের মধ্যেই আরো এক হাত বাড়তে পারে
আমরা বেগমগঞ্জ ইউনিয়ন থেকে 36 জন ভলান্টিয়ার ইউনিয়ন পরিষদ থেকে প্রশিক্ষণ নিছি প্রত্যেকটা ওয়ার্ড থেকে 4 জন করি আমরা আগামীতে ইউনিয়ন পরিষদে যেন ইউনিয়ন পরিষদের নেতৃত্বে প্রত্যেকটা ওয়ার্ডে আমরা কাজ করতে পারি
So ladies and gentlemen, moving along to our next agenda, you'll be hearing a presentation that will be delivered by Mrs. Nigar Dil Nahar, Program Policy Officer, BDCO. For Mrs. Nigar Dil Nahar, the time is yours.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much, moderator. You are doing an excellent job. So back to the presentation. So I think this video has already showed how WFP along with the government is implementing one of the successful program focused on financing and the role of volunteer is very much visible. So today I'm going to share this some of the success stories of our program that we are implementing in Kurigram district, one of the most poverty prone and flood prone districts, in collaboration with obviously Ministry of Disaster Management and so. In the humanitarian community, the focus-based financing has gained significant momentum in recent years. Evidence has shown that the focus-based financing is a faster, more efficient, more impactful, and more dignified way to respond to the climate shock. Disaster should not take us by surprise. Nowadays, science and technology is so advanced that we can predict or forecast most of the hazards with a decent lead time. So we should be able to anticipate the disasters and take actions before before it's going to make a devastation in the community. You know, the forecast-based financing is an activity that takes place prior to an extreme weather event and based on forecast trigger to mitigate the anticipated impact on food security, life, livelihood, and also health, education, and other sectors. Forecast-based financing uses credible weather forecasts to determine ahead of time where a hazard may occur and flexible pre-arranged financing so that an appropriate action can be taken ahead of a climate shock. WFP, in collaboration with the Ministry of Disaster Management and Relief, has designed and tested forecast-based financing tool as a part of the WFP's integrated risk management approach. In 2019, WFP for the first time supported 4,000 beneficiaries in the flood-prone areas with an advanced cash package at least 3 to 4 days before flood. This helps them to take preemptive, the community people, preemptive activities such as buying food, medicine, and emergency evacuation. The successful pilot in Kurigram district achieved an excellent recognition worldwide. As a result, Bangladesh was selected for the global pilot by UN OCHA and accomplished a significant result in 2020. In 2020, WFP, along with other UN agencies, FAO, UNICEF, UNFPA, and Bangladesh Red Crescent Society, implemented anticipatory action and supported around 20,000 people in the flood-prone 5 districts. We know the role of volunteers is extremely important in FPF. Volunteers work together with Union Disaster Management Committee members to help the beneficiary to take disaster preparedness. WFP, in collaboration with Ministry of Disaster Management and Relief, developed a community-based early warning dissemination framework and utilized the local volunteers and UDMC members to disseminate the flood early warning to the remote villages. So Bangladesh altogether has around 4,500 unions, and each union has one union disaster management committee. And not only union, also union disaster management committee is extended to the ward level as well. So Upazila district, Upazila union and ward level, Bangladesh government has union disaster management committee, and they play extremely important role in disaster preparedness, disaster risk reduction, early warning dissemination, and also emergency response. So for FPF, advanced cash transfer is to send the advanced cash to the beneficiary, advanced targeting is a key. In 2021, WFP and UN agencies, other UN agencies, developed an anticipatory action common database of 130,000 households for the efficient targeting and early cash transfer. The volunteers also played an active role in mobilizing the community and database preparation. This program, jointly with definitely UDMC, utilized volunteers to identify the flood hotspots and also mobilize the community members to enroll them in the registration system. The FP working group in the country helps ensure governance and coordination with all stakeholders. This platform also played an active role in advocacy with government. As a result, FPF task force was included in the national standing order on disaster. This has created an enormous opportunity to mainstream anticipatory action in the national disaster management system. So this standing order and disaster has very specific roles and mentioned about very specific roles and responsibility for the disaster management committee. So disaster management committee, whatever they implement in the field level, based on this SOD, the role and responsibility that is mentioned in the SOD. So it is well defined and well articulated so that volunteers or DNC members can understand what role they need to play during, before, and after disaster. Bangladesh government also has a plan. In fact, in last 3 to 4 years, the Ministry of Disaster Management and Relief is trying to develop a flood preparedness program similar to the CPP program, which is a global model. And we believe that in the flood-prone area, as of now, there is no flood preparedness program, but government is trying to develop this flood preparedness program, who will jointly work with the Union Disaster Management Committee. So we believe that the learning these two countries are sharing at this moment will be helpful to establish a successful flood preparedness program in the flood-prone area. And our purpose is financing. Our anticipatory action will be able to use this flood preparedness program to identify the geographical disaster hotspots and also easy targeting and cash transfer before flood, so that people can take preemptive activities, preparedness, and save their lives. So that's it from my side. Over to you, moderator.
Thank you, Mrs. Nigar, for your presentation. So once again, on behalf of everyone here, I would like to say thank you for your very delightful presentation. And once again, thank you for all the speakers, Mr. Sukamsi, Mr. Nanan, and also Mrs. Farida. This is the end of presentation session. And we're going to the next agenda is question and answer session. So let me read to you some questions that has been collected by the committee. And we have several feedback and also questions. And the first question is from Ayub from Dinas Sosial for Bangladesh. So the first question may be for Mrs. Nigar. Mrs. Nigar, how is the women involvement for disaster response in Bangladesh? As mentioned before, does Bangladesh have a community for women that is accommodated by the government?
Thank you very much. Definitely. Women actually play a leading role in the disaster preparedness, and it is established. We all know that they are the first responders. And in volunteer system of Bangladesh government, like Union Disaster Management Committee and other volunteers associations, there is a provision for women participation, and it is mandatory. So all Union Disaster Management Committees have female members, and they are equally playing active role in the disaster preparedness and also emergency response. So this is a global government mandate, and definitely these volunteers and associations and also this union, these disaster management committees have a very active role of women throughout the year.
Okay, thank you, Mrs. Nigeria. And we're going to the next session, the next question. The second question is from one of our audience. The question is for the representative of Tagana. And I would like to invite maybe Mrs. Farida or Mr. Sukamsi to answer the question. So the next question is how Indonesia ensures the youth and women representatives can be accepted and get along with the older generation. So, Mrs. Farida, would you like to please answer the question?
Ya, terima kasih pertanyaannya. Saya akan mencoba menjawab sesuai dengan pengalaman saya di lapangan. Saya bisa melakukan tugas yang tidak bisa dilakukan oleh kaum lelaki. Seperti yang di lapangan, saya sering mendampingi ibu-ibu untuk berkeluh kesah, untuk curhat, di mana dia di tenda itu selalu dia itu pengen yang enak di sana itu. Jadi dia itu pengen enak, pengen apa ya? Kebutuhannya itu dipenuhi. Jadi kita itu selalu menyiapkan semua itu, dan kita juga bisa dan saya juga bisa mendampingi anak-anak juga di sana. selain tugas-tugas operasional di lapangan, saya juga ikut dilibatkan mempersiapkan perencanaan kegiatan. Di dalam Tagana tidak membeda-bedakan lelaki dan perempuan, itu sama. Terima kasih.
Okay, thank you, Mrs. Ferida, for answering the question and for sharing your experiences as Tagana representative. The same question for Mrs. Niger. How Bangladesh ensures that youth and women representative can be accepted and get along with the older generation?
Okay, I think these questions I have already answered, but since it's related to women, I'm very much happy to reply this again. So, so disaster management is everybody's business. It is not that one agency or one people can play an active role. It needs collective effort from the community. So women, since I mentioned earlier, women are the first responder to the disaster management. Why I say this? Because in the family, when family is affected, first responder is women. They take care of their family and they take care of their family members and also their community. So nowadays, I mean, since independence, we have seen that there are so many initiatives have been taken to involve women in the volunteerism, and they are actively participating in disaster management. And it is not only that that number. It's not that they are only attend the meetings or take part in the meetings or activities. They are actively involved. They raise their voice, they talk their problems, and also they share their needs and what they actually want for their community. So this is clearly mentioned in the policy, women policy of Bangladesh government, and also standing order on disaster. There is a clear mentioning that how women should be involved in the disaster management different phases, and what would be their role, and how they can play an active role in the disaster management for their family, for community, and also local government. So I think I have replied your question.
Okay, thank you, Mrs. Niger, for sharing and answer the question. And we're going to the next question. Maybe this is the last question for Mr. Nana. Yeah. So, Mr. Nana, how Indonesia ensure that the youth groups updated with the latest issues such as climate change and then gender or disability inclusion? The time is yours. Mr. Nana?
Baik, terima kasih. Jadi untuk penanganan kelompok-kelompok rentan, justru ini mendapatkan prioritas. Kami sangat mengutamakan pelayanan kebutuhan-kebutuhan dasar bagi penyintas atau pengungsi yang dari kelompok rentan ini. Karena anak-anak, ibu hamil, lansia itu butuh penanganan yang serius. Ya, karena itu kami berikan pelayanan yang eksklusif bagi mereka. Ya, dari mulai makanannya kita bedakan. Antara anak-anak, dewasa dan lansia kita bedakan. Termasuk juga hunian mereka kita sangat prioritaskan. Dan kami Tagana juga memiliki yang namanya tim layanan dukungan psikososial. Nah, tim ini bertugas mendampingi terutama kelompok-kelompok rentan agar mereka lebih tenang, karena korban bencana ini mereka kebanyakan mengalami trauma setelah kejadian. Kami tim Tagana mengajak anak-anak untuk bermain walaupun di lokasi bencana, mereka kita upayakan agar suasana hatinya tidak terganggu. Jadi kami menurunkan tim untuk melayani mereka. Baik, mengenai regenerasi kita melakukan terus edukasi-edukasi kepada masyarakat, kepada relawan-relawan agar kita selalu menginformasikan apa yang dibutuhkan oleh masyarakat terutama terkait dengan materi-materi kebencanaan. Mungkin itu yang bisa kami sampaikan.
Oke, okay, thank you Mr. Nana. So education for the volunteer, ya. Yeah? Thank you Mr. Nana and maybe same question for Mrs. Niger. How Bangladesh ensure that the youth groups updated with the latest issues such as climate change, gender or disability inclusion?
Okay. So so our Union Disaster Management Committee has a mandate to include older person with disability along with other members. So it is mandatory for each and every DMCs has this membership for these people who are actually generally excluded from the society. So this helps disaster managers to understand the needs they have in a particular situation, especially the person with disabilities and older person along with women. So this is mandated, and again I mentioned that as I mentioned before, standing order on disaster, which is the key document for Bangladesh government to implement disaster management program efficiently, has clearly mentioned about this mandate and how these members can be involved in the committees and other volunteers associations. So WFP also formed a volunteers group in Kurigram district as a part of our anticipatory reaction program, and they get training from the Union Disaster Management Committee and other disaster management committees and a local government. And this volunteers group also involved women, person with disability, and also older person. So older persons, definitely they play very good role because they have indigenous knowledge and they can encourage young volunteers to play their role in a more active way.
Okay, thank you Mrs. Niger to answer the question. And once again, ladies and gentlemen, this is the end of question and answer session and also the end of this second discussion session. Once again, thank you so much Mrs. Niger. Thank you Mr. Sukamsi, Mr. Nana and also Mrs. Ferida for this very delightful discussion in the second session. Thank you so much. So, ladies and so ladies and gentlemen, the previous two sessions are both very interesting, but we still have another agendas, and following next, we will have another delightful discussion for the plenary session. So in this session, we will have four speakers who will join us in this plenary session. They are the first one, Mr. Ahmadul Haq from MOMDR, and the next one is Mr. Pete Fogden from Deputy Country Director WFP Bangladesh, and the next speakers is Mrs. Krista Rader, WFP Representative Indonesia Country Office, and the last speakers is Mr. Ian Kusmadiana from MOSA. So to begin this session, we would like to invite our moderator to lead this plenary session. And without any further ado, so ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Mr. Afianto Amri, PhD. The time is yours.
Baik, bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Selamat siang. Sebaik SBK. Good afternoon, everyone. We are now in the plenary session. We have four distinguished speakers, like our colleague from the MC has already mentioned. Two are based in Bangladesh and the other two are based in Indonesia. So it will be a really interesting discussions and fruitful. Participants in this webinar, please also feel free to provide your comments, questions, or suggestions in the Q&A button or on the chat panel so that we can capture your remarks and to be responded by the panelists as well. Okay. First, allow me to introduce Mr. Ahmadul Haq profile, but before that, maybe we can have the video bumper first to see it. Back to the host, please. Fantastic. Mr. Ahmadul Haq is currently leading the Community-Based Organization Cyclone Preparedness Program, or CPP, focusing on minimization of disaster risk posed to coastal communities for building disaster resilient society. This program has been working relentlessly since 1972. Mr. Haq is a veteran government civil service official with over 25 years of field experience in combating disasters. Under his leadership, the organization has won the United Nations Public Service Award in 2021 for its unprecedented progress in women's empowerment in disaster management. Recently, Mr. Ahmadul led the organization switching from its primary mandate of cyclone response to multi-hazard intervention and dealing with climate change-induced disasters. Glad that we have Mr. Ahmadul again with us. How are you, Mr. Ahmadul?
Yes, I am fine. Thank you very much.
Great. Yes, allow me to move to the first question. We have a really interesting one when we've seen from the videos and sharing today about the various initiatives that have been undertaken by the government of Indonesia and its partners. We recognize as well the Bangladesh experience in combating cyclones using forecast-based financing and empowering women in disaster management. We have heard as well about the Indonesia experience on volunteers and coordination with humanitarian organizations. Now, our questions to you, Mr. Ahmadul, is: are there any activities or initiatives that Bangladesh would be interested to learn from Indonesia? Over to you.
Thank you very much. My organization, under the Ministry of Disaster Management and Relief of Bangladesh, has been engaging in community-based disaster risk reduction since 1972. We are now more than 50 years experienced community-based organization. We basically do early warning dissemination, search and rescue evacuation, first aid, and other DRR activities under the guidance of our government. I have said in my first opening talks, it is a Red Cross, Red Crescent originated effort, and now it is totally government engagement. So far in this session, it was a very excellent interactive session I have gone through. We shared our community engaged disaster risk reduction, how our volunteers disseminate early warning systems, evacuate vulnerable people, do search and rescue, first aid in the time of disaster. And of course, we also tried to share how we are going forward with more youth engagement, women empowerment. I must be thankful to Ms. Nigar Dilnar. She talked about our women empowerment, how we made the success. It was excellent, but I want to add some few points. What was the prevalent gap in women empowerment in our, or women engagement in our disaster risk reduction was, actually, I will be talking about the responder side. Our women volunteers were one third. They were behind in numbers comparing to male counterparts. They were of less capability, less capacity, less engagement, and there was actually zero leadership. This was the was to address by our government. And then we made the gender parity in numbers. We made the volunteers equal. then we are going through their capacity development, equipment distribution training, increasing engagement. Now our focus actually increased leadership of women volunteers. Anyway, it was well discussed. We see Indonesian side basically from Tagana, how they work with the community, their approach, tools, and techniques. We are very interested to know how their community engagement with the vulnerable area. We want to see more closely. We want to share our knowledge, from our country context and their context. Actually, the two contexts are more or less different. But vulnerability and addressing the community risk are all the same. So we will be happy to see some more specific tools, how they engage people in disaster risk reduction. In our country, we basically do disaster risk reduction in the field by our volunteers. How you do, we want to hear. Thank you.
Fantastic. Thank you very much, Mr. Ahmadu. It's really interesting. I just realized your program is actually older than me. So I have to commend that very much. And it's really interesting that the program itself is initially was led by the civil society, but it's now owned by the government itself. The point about the women empowerment, having increased leadership for women volunteers is certainly something that we can explore and we can further discuss. And also what you mentioned earlier about how community engagement with vulnerable or at-risk groups and trying to know and exchange tools that have been used for empowering the communities. Really interesting. Thank you very much, Mr. Ahmadu. Excellent. So it's a really good start when we want to move to the next speaker. Allow me to invite Mr. Pak Ian Kusmadiana, and may we have his profile now with the video. Back to the host, please.
Umban.
Right, I think there's a glitch. So may I invite first Mr. Ian Kusmadiana, or I usually call him Pak Ian. Pak Ian is a strong supporter of civil society movement for disaster resilience. He is currently spearheading the division under the Ministry of Social Affairs, who works on the ground when disaster strikes, ensuring people affected receive sufficient and appropriate humanitarian assistance and protections in a coordinated and effective manner. Under his leadership, he works with more than 100 humanitarian agencies in Indonesia, as well as commanding more than 39,000 volunteers across Indonesia, who works with community to support on risk reduction, preparedness response, as well as recovery. Now, Pak Ian, how are you first, Pak? Right. Excellent.
Alhamdulillah.
Alhamdulillah. Thank you very much. Great to have you here. We have heard from Mr. Ahmadu on the interest from Bangladesh, learning from Indonesia. Now we have you, your time with the same question to Indonesia. You mentioned earlier about the coordination that the ministry is leading with hundreds of humanitarian organizations and tens of thousands of volunteers. We learned as well from Bangladesh about their cyclone preparedness program. And we know as well that wind hazards is actually one of the fastest growing hazards in Indonesia, with storms, cyclones, typhoons. It's growing as well in many parts of Indonesia. Now, capitalizing on this, Pak Ian, what do you think that would be interesting for Indonesians to learn from the experiences of Bangladesh? Over to you, Pak Ian.
Ya, terima kasih. Saya melihat tadi paparan dari teman-teman dari Bangladesh tentang bagaimana sama-sama bagaimana pentingnya kesiapsiagaan yang kita utamakan untuk menghadapi bencana. Dan ini adalah hal yang sangat penting untuk kegiatan pelanggaran bencana, bagaimana kita menyiapkan lebih bagus daripada kita melaksanakan kegiatan sudah terjadi, kita harus fokus lebih besar kepada kesiapsiagaan. Dan Bangladesh sudah berusaha melaksanakan hal itu. Nah, ada perbedaan memang sedikit dari Bangladesh dan Indonesia, di mana Bangladesh itu jenis bencananya lebih banyak kepada hidrometeorologi, ya, kepada air, kemudian kepada angin puting beliung kalau di sini, atau disebutnya dengan angin topan atau apa, ya. Nah, itu. Nah, jadi sehingga hal-hal tersebut adalah hal-hal yang bisa kita lihat dan bisa digunakan Indonesia bagaimana kecepatan kecepatan Bangladesh dalam bentuk kesiapsiagaan bencana. Namun di Indonesia ada beberapa hal yang kita tidak bisa memprediksi kejadian bencana yang jauh datang tiba-tiba, seperti misalnya ada gempa bumi, ya kan, yang di Indonesia yang sering terjadi setiap saat di Indonesia ada. Nah, hal itu maka Indonesia menempatkan masyarakat lebih jauh lagi, lebih dahsyat lagi. Jadi masyarakat harus benar-benar dibuat siap untuk menghadapi situasi bencana. Untuk siap itu, maka mereka harus tahu bahwa dia dalam kondisi situasi rawan bencana, di lokasinya rawan bencana. Itu yang pertama. Dan yang kedua, dia harus tahu apa yang dilakukan ketika terjadi bencana. Siapa berbuat apa, SOP secara harus disiapkan. Dan yang ketiga, kita harus siapkan berbagai bantuan atau berbagai peralatan yang mungkin dia bisa lakukan untuk melaksanakan bencana pada masa awal respon terhadap bencana. Sehingga dengan situasi seperti itu, mereka punya SOP yang cukup jelas, kemudian dengan bantuan yang cukup jelas, kita simulasikan mereka bagaimana melakukan penanggulangan bencana itu oleh masyarakat sendiri, dari mereka, untuk mereka. Nah, kemudian kalau ada bencana, bisa mereka untuk melaksanakan penanggulangan bencana. Nah, ini tidak akan rugi bagi kita, karena kalaupun itu tidak ada bencana, mereka akan jadi modal sosial bagi mereka. Tapi kalau ada bencana, itu menjadi pengurang risiko bencana bagi kita semua. Nah, ini yang kita lakukan di Indonesia. Jadi ada persamaan dan ada perbedaan. Karena perbedaan mungkin karena situasinya di Indonesia lebih kompleks mengenai bencananya daripada di Bangladesh. Sepertinya saya melihat seperti itu. Karena dari pagi tadi menceritakan dua hal yang besar. Satu itu mengenai banjir, ya. Yang kedua mengenai badai, ya, badai banjir dan juga dengan angin topan seperti itu. Nah, ini dilakukan. Kemudian selain itu, kami selaku untuk mengkoordinir seluruh relawan, baik itu yang berasal dari asuransi pemerintah, ada yang berasal dari masyarakat, ada dunia usaha, ada yang dari NGO lokal internasional, ya, kami mengelola atau mengkoordinir seluruh potensi-potensi yang ada. Sampai dengan sini sejak tahun 2014 kami sudah mengkoordinir itu. Mengkoordinir dan sudah nyata bisa digunakan untuk penanggulangan bencana, baik itu kemarin terakhir kita di Pasaman Barat, di Pasaman, atau kita lakukan di Gunung Meletus kemarin di Semeru, ya, kemudian kita juga lakukan penanggulangan bencana di Palu dan sebagainya, di NTB, gempa bumi, sebagainya, itu dilakukan. Nah, setidaknya dari pengalaman kami punya 4 di situ, yang hal yang kita bisa lakukan secara bersama-sama dalam satu koordinasi klaster nasional penanggulangan bencana. Yaitu yang pertama adalah bagaimana kita bisa melakukan pengerahan sumber daya yang terarah. Punya permasalahan yang kita sepakati bersama dan sumber daya kita masing-masing punya, kita arahkan semua untuk supaya bisa kita lebih terarah dan lebih fokus dan tidak timpang tindih. Nah, yang kedua adalah terkait dengan bagaimana kita melakukan dalam koordinasi itu, ya, kita melakukan menggunakan SOP pemperkayaan, SOP yang bermacam-macam, berbagai-bagai, saling melengkapi. Itu yang kita ingin selalu lakukan. Jadi itu yang dilakukan sehingga bisa dilaksanakan dengan baik, efektif. Nah, yang ketiga adalah substitusi kita lakukan. Jadi saling mengganti. Jadi kalau misalkan Kementerian Sosial dengan koordinator Kasas PP sekarang melaksanakan kegiatan di Pasaman Barat, atau kita melaksanakan kegiatan sekarang di erupsi Gunung Semeru, maka masing-masing bisa menggantikan atas nama Kasas PP. di sana untuk mewakili dan untuk saling didukung dari luar. Nah, ini yang kita lakukan, sehingga yang nomor 4 yang kita sampaikan bahwa ternyata bersinergi itu indah. Bersinergi itu bisa dilaksanakan dengan rencana dalam saat pra, saat, dan pasca. Kami bergerak dari pra, saat, dan pasca, tidak hanya pada tanggap darurat. Nah, ini yang kami lakukan, sehingga kita bisa mengoptimalkan sampai dengan saat ini penanganan korban bencana melalui pengklasteran yang kita lakukan, khususnya di klaster pengungsian dan perlindungan. Nah, dan di situ juga teman-teman kita lakukan bahwa saya di situ banyak juga sekarang teman-teman yang NGO yang merapat pada kami untuk melaksanakan kegiatan pengungsian secara bersama-sama, termasuk NGO-NGO lokal atau internasional banyak untuk melakukan kepada kami. Ini mungkin ada sedikit kesamaan dan perbedaan, dan tetap kami akan melihat tadi banyak hal yang harus kita pelajari dari Bangladesh, terutama tadi sejak tahun 50 sekian itu sudah ada kegiatan kerelawanan dipimpin kepemudaan di situ. Nah, tentunya kami harus belajar bagaimana mengelolanya, relawannya begitu banyak ya di Bangladesh, dan juga bagaimana bisa memelihara atau menjaga irama kontinunya dari awal sampai sekarang bisa tetap berkiprah dengan baik. Nah, ini sangat penting kita pelajari, sehingga ke depan saya ingin sekali belajar melalui kerelawanan, pengelolaan dan pengorganisasian relawan di Bangladesh ya, terutama terkait dengan tadi kegiatan-kegiatan yang saya sampaikan untuk kegiatan-kegiatan di kesiapsiagaan. Terima kasih.
Fantastic. Thank you very much, Pak Ian. Terima kasih. So, Pak Ian has highlighted about the Indonesia experience first on particularly on rapid onset disasters, where disaster strikes anytime without a warning. He also mentioned that the importance on knowing who's doing what and when, about how services and facilities and equipment needs to be ready to be mobilized, as well as to have standard operating procedures or SOPs to a clear guidance for mobilizing resources. He also mentioned about the collaborations among different agencies, organizations, not just between governments, but also between the NGOs, private sectors, and other groups who is working together on humanitarian responses. He also mentioned about division of roles, which is interesting, and leaderships, where in some places there needs to have like a strong leadership in coordination as well as in implementing response. Pak Ian also highlight that it's interesting how Bangladesh experience in doing preparedness as well as establishing early warning. He also highlighted that maintaining a 50-year program is not easy. So it would be interesting to learn about how Bangladesh experience in maintaining that consistency or sustainability aspects in making sure that the program is still benefiting and useful for the communities. Thank you very much, Pak Ian. Now, we have heard insights from Bangladesh and Indonesia colleagues. Now I want to invite Krista Raeder, a representative from WFP Indonesia. May we have the video first, please. So. Great. Krista, thank you for having here. How are you?
I'm fine, thank you. It has been an extremely interesting exchange for me. I know Bangladesh, but I do not know Indonesia that well. Unfortunately, the COVID-19 pandemic came in between. But I have realized that there is a tremendous strength in both countries that builds on volunteerism, on community engagement. And the government needs to work with the community strengths in order to be successful. This is a commonality. No matter if the disasters are more predictable or less predictable. In Bangladesh, they are more predictable. In Indonesia, some are predictable and many are not, like the earthquakes, volcano eruptions, etc. There is to be knowledge for good practices to be built up throughout the life cycle. When Indonesia presented the Tagana Goes to School, I realized it is something that needs to start very early in life. A sense for what do I have to do? What can I contribute for my community? And this needs to become part of the school curriculum, which apparently it is in Indonesia. I do not know about Bangladesh. Probably it is also there. We started the discussion today on the involvement of youth and the importance and the strengths of youth. But when we were discussing, we went into many, many different directions, which are equally important. Very prominent became the involvement of women in our discussions in both countries. And then the care for elderly, the care for disabled people, the care for children, all these are dimensions which would be worth another round of discussion. We also realized that it is fundamental to look at the whole cycle of disaster management and to start as early as possible in the preparedness. And I think both countries have realized this very well and have taken action on it very well. Otherwise, they wouldn't have been so successful in reducing fatalities and affected people in general. Also, the preventative measures for through planting mangroves. There's a lot that can be done early on. It's not just the warning a week ahead. It starts much earlier. And maybe there is some more to be learned from each other. In preparation of continued learning, if you so wish, we would need to document the two different systems and exchange, and then see where the countries would want to hear more about each other. However, I believe seeing and experiencing it would make all the difference. And I would strongly suggest that we aim to get some more funding. And now that the world is opening up again, we also do exchange visits. Because seeing the reality and exchanging with the people on the ground will open up new perspectives of which we may not have thought yet. So this is my offer, that we would try to offer more in terms of exchange, but also in terms of experiencing a visit to another, to the other country, if there is a wish to do so. So I thank you so much. It's been very enriching for me. And I wish you a great rest of the day from my end. And I wait for feedback on which road we should take. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Krista. Thank you on highlighting the importance of disaster education as well as the specific needs of at-risk groups and also the importance of looking at the whole cycles. I think my personal observation is these countries are champions in DRR itself among the world. So Bangladesh and Indonesia are being observed by many countries in the rest of the world. So clearly, South-South corporations exchange between one another, as well as maybe exchanging both experiences to the rest of the world, will be really, really interesting. And I think you strike the really good point when if the world is already opening up and there's no more variants, hopefully, a direct observation and experiences is a really interesting suggestion to explore. Thank you very much, Krista. Now, let me move to the next panelist, which is Piet Vogten. Then maybe we can have the video first before. Back to the host, please. Excellent. Mr. Vogten, great to have you here. It's interesting to learn from your opening remarks that it's obvious that you know Indonesia very well in the old days, and also now you have been working in Bangladesh for over 3 years. You also mentioned the importance of role of women, their capacities, as well as their vulnerabilities as well. You clearly familiar with both contexts in both countries. So my question probably is, what is your suggestion for the learning process and the knowledge exchange to also transcend in discussing these issues, the gender equality, women empowerment, youth engagement, and disability inclusion, how these aspects can be an integral part of the learning process? Over to you, Mr. Pip.
Thank you very much. Your question covers about the study for another 5 or 6 PhDs, but let me try to do a little attempt to talk to this. I'd like to agree with what Krista has just said about the world opening up, getting people to come together and meet each other again in person. That is definitely useful. But at the same time, I think that what we are doing now, webinars, which is really something that we have learned through the COVID context, because we had to talk to each other through video, can be useful and can be a good combination, in fact. I was looking, we had 168 people online at some stage here today. You can't organize a trip for, let's assume half of them were from Indonesia. You can't have 90 people from Indonesia coming to Bangladesh. Even if we managed to get good resources, that would be too challenging. So you could have a combination wherein a few people come here and then we have a video link and then we can still have the conversations so that the people who come here can be the eyes for those who are back home, and then it can go the other way around when we have a return visit. That would be something useful. That would also be something useful in having a diverse group of people, having some disabled people, having some women, having some of those special group people coming here, who then can talk to their peers and translate to the people back home who would be online to do this. Having worked in both countries, I realized there's a lot of similarities. There's also differences. Bangladesh, though it's cut into pieces with a lot of rivers, it's a compact country. Indonesia is 5,000 kilometers from one end to the other, thousands of islands. So logistics are challenging. Logistics are different, even though there's water in both countries. So there are some things that could be useful in how to learn to deal with that. What I also believe is important, and where both countries can learn, but both countries can also further strengthen on, is what is the role of private sector in all these disaster response context. I've been in this business, I normally say, from last century, so for quite a number of years. And I come from the generation where we would do everything. But as I see now, and as we see again with the pandemic, private sector has an important role to play. And that's where it's important that we start thinking at how can we better engage private sector. And the work that we have seen today, engaging these volunteers, engaging the youth, can be really a stepping stone to also start using private sector infrastructure, private sector methods, private sector technologies. I'm thinking of these things here. Mobile phones, they have such strength nowadays, things that you can do. We don't have to set up parallel systems if it is already there and if the private sector can provide those things. And exploring how this can work, we can really learn from what happens in both countries and see how we can make things better. So thank you, back to you.
Excellent. Thank you very much, Mr. Pitt. It's a really interesting point. Indeed, having the pandemic with transformation of digital technology is an interesting lessons learned, and also doing it as a combination of between online and offline experience, maybe this, that those are something that we can invest on in trying to enabling the learning experiences. And I think you also mentioned a really good point where digital technologies is actually more receptive coming from the younger generations. They're more adaptable and more they can use they can do many things with their gadgets today. And that's strike with the common theme of this event, which is about also about youth engagement as well. Now on, I want to turn back to Mr. Ahmadul Haq and Pak Ian, both from Bangladesh and Indonesia. I think Krista and Pete has already mentioned and also suggest about doing more intensive or invest in more learnings and exchanges, also including with direct observations, which include also visits. Maybe the first question to Mr. Ahmadul is, how would you respond to that? Would you be open to that possibilities? And then I will have, and also maybe what's your concerns, observations, or suggestions to make this work? And then also my question to Pak Ian is maybe doing more particular on the youth engagement part. So how would you, what would be your strategy in making, in trying to also engage between youth and also the context of women to be also be part of this process, to have a meaningful or an active participation on this exchange? Maybe then the first with Ahmadul and then goes back to Pak Ian. Mr. Ahmadul, the time is yours.
Thank you again. I'm very much interested to hear the plenary session. Excellent so far I heard. I have said earlier, we have some successes like policy and legal framework, our standing orders and disasters. Another success we have achieved, that is disability inclusive disaster risk management. Bangladesh has led two international conferences in our country and made Dhaka Declaration and Dhaka Declaration Plus on disability inclusive disaster risk management. We can share our experience and knowledge with Indonesian counterparts. And we are actually our disaster profile, all the same except volcanic eruption is the difference between us. We are not, we are out of this danger actually, and other contexts are same, community engagement, and we have a huge potential risk of earthquakes, and we are really lacking knowledge and experience here. We can get knowledge from Indonesia, from this side, beside that, torrential rain, landslide, his threats also our concern. So we can get knowledge from practical knowledge from Indonesia, and I'm hopeful about a operational platform from the two government side. Ministry of Disaster Management and Relief is actually very keen to working together in this cooperational platform. Thank you.
Excellent. Thank you very much, Pak Ahmadu. I see that there's a positive response and receptions on that. Thank you very much. And it's really interesting to hear that. And then my next question to Pak Ian, but also there is another one that is relevant from the Q&A. It's about disability inclusion as well. So Pak Ian, so the aspects between youth, women, and people with disabilities for the context in learning on this knowledge exchange, what would be your strategy? What would be your advice for all of us? Over to you, Pak Ian.
Baik, terima kasih. Jadi kalau untuk pemuda dan perempuan, dari dasarnya ya kita sudah sejak lama memberikan kesempatan yang luas kepada para pemuda untuk ikut serta berpartisipasi dalam rangkaian bencana, laki-laki ataupun perempuan. Maka kami sudah mendirikan Taruna Siaga Bencana. Taruna itu pemuda, semuanya isinya pemuda. Batas umurnya itu di bawah 48, di atas 17 tahun semua. Jadi kita melaksanakan itu, kalau berbicara Tagana, ya berbicara perempuan, dan berbicara juga berbicara pemuda. Jadi modal dasarnya sudah pasti ini. Jadi kalau kami mempunyai pengalaman yang kami tadi sampaikan oleh teman-teman, baik itu Pak Nana, kemudian Pak Sukamsi, Ibu Ferry, itu semua adalah dari pemuda. Dan apa yang dilakukan oleh mereka, itu adalah kegiatan-kegiatan pemuda juga, gitu kan. Nah, oleh karena itu, kami bisa memberikan gambaran yang lebih luas terkait atau lebih detail. Jadi kalau nanti ada session lain, baik itu melalui apapun secara fisik ataupun tidak secara fisik, untuk melakukan sharing session terkait dengan kegiatan-kegiatan pemudaan dan perencanaan ini yang dilakukan oleh Taruna Siaga Bencana. Yang kami ceritakan itu hanya sebagian kecil yang kami sampaikan, seperti contoh-contoh tadi Tagana masuk sekolah, kemudian terkait dengan pembuatan atau penanaman mangrove, ya tadi sampaikan oleh teman-teman, itu hanya sebagian yang ada di Indonesia yang dilakukan oleh pemuda. Padahal bagaimana prosesi daripada pembuatan kegiatan untuk mangrove itu tadi tidak diceritakan. Bagaimana tadi tim yang dari Kebumen itu kami lengkapi, itu bagaimana dia merangkul orang-orang, mohon maaf, dari anak jalanan kita rangkul, kemudian kita sadarkan, dia menolak tentunya di awal, tapi kita berikan contoh bagaimana diajak untuk membuat perubahan di lingkungannya, membuat kepada masyarakat menanamkan mangrove, dari yang tadinya tidak mau, menjadi mau, dan dia sendiri akhirnya ikut serta dalam rangkaian bencana, dan sekarang sudah menjadi contoh di masyarakat itu, dan sudah menjadi seorang fasilitator mangrove yang unggul di Indonesia sekarang seperti itu. Nah, ini kan bagaimana Indonesia mengangkat cara-cara ke penanganan bencana yang melibatkan pemuda lebih luas dengan perempuan. Nah, tadi juga di contoh di mangrove juga ada perempuannya, itu banyak yang ikut serta dalam kegiatan itu. Nah, begitu juga dalam kegiatan Tagana masuk sekolah, itu juga kami laki-laki perempuan, bahkan lebih banyak perempuannya daripada laki-lakinya untuk melakukan kegiatan sosialisasi kepada anak-anak SD, SMP, atau TK, karena mereka lebih halus untuk melakukan sosialisasinya. Nah, contoh-contoh ini bisa diberikan atau diketukularkan pada teman-teman di Bangladesh dan sebagainya. Nah, ini yang kami akan buka open terkait dengan hal tersebut.
I think there's a slight connection issue.
Suara saya masih kedengar nggak?
Masih Pak Ian. Yes, we can still hear you. Can you hear us?
Yes, loud and clear.
Yes. Okay, while well, waiting with from Pak Ian, he mentioned about how the volunteer program has expanded. So not just strictly about disaster response, but also about environmental protections, goes to school, etc. I see that I think Pak Ian is back here. Pak Ian, you're still on mute.
Okay, saya lanjutkan. Yes. Baik, terima Please. Kasih. Mohon maaf. Jadi terkait dengan tadi, contoh-contoh tadi yang kami sampaikan, itu merupakan contoh-contoh yang bisa sebetulnya lebih jelas kami jelaskan kalau waktunya panjang. Banyak cerita tentang perempuan, bahkan sekarang di Indonesia ini, di anak-anak perempuan dan pemuda itu dilibatkan bagaimana tentang pemberdayaan pengungsi. Jadi contoh, tadi disampaikan oleh dari Jawa Timur, Ferry, ya, itu bagaimana masyarakat korban bencana pengungsi ibu-ibu yang ada di Semeru sekarang dilatih bagaimana untuk bisa produktif pemberdayaan, bagaimana dia dilatih bagaimana membuat kue, bagaimana dia membuat bakso dan sebagainya untuk dijual. Nah, itu juga menjadi bahan bagaimana anak-anak muda kita, perempuan maupun laki-laki untuk kegiatan pembencana tidak hanya bekerja pada saat prabencana. Tadi penanaman pohon atau di pasca di dapur umum terlibat semua anak-anak laki-laki untuk bikin dapur umum di tanggap darurat. Tapi di pasca bencana pun kami tetap sudah melaksanakan kegiatan hal tersebut, yaitu pemberdayaan-pemberdayaan pengungsi dan sebagainya. Nah, ini yang sekarang kita lakukan di Kementerian Sosial melalui Tanah Siaga dan Kampung Siaga Bencana. Kampung Siaga Bencana pun sama, rata-rata itu adalah anak-anak muda dan ada anak-anak muda, pemuda, ya laki-laki dan perempuan. Kami tidak pernah membedakan laki-laki dan perempuan. Kita sama-sama bekerja, siapa yang bisa, is okay. Banyak rescuer di Tagana itu dari perempuan. Banyak dokter di Tagana itu perempuan. Banyak guru di Tagana itu dari perempuan. Semua ikut serta dengan pelanggan bencana bersama-sama spesifikasinya. Jadi jangan salah, banyak yang menjadi koki untuk pemberlangan bencana itu laki-laki, tidak hanya perempuan. Nah ini jadi beda dari kita selalu melakukan itu, tidak memandang itu perempuan laki-laki. Koki-koki handal juga di Tagana sekarang kebanyakan dari laki-laki. Perempuan nggak apa-apa, dia bisa bantu ngiris dan sebagainya semuanya. Nah itulah kami tidak membedakan bagaimana laki-laki dan perempuan dalam pelanggan bencana, perannya kami samakan, silakan sepanjang itu masih dalam kapasitas perempuan, sepanjang itu masih di kapasitas laki-laki. Saya kira kami sangat menyambut baik apa yang akan dilakukan oleh Ibu Chris Rader dan Peter Pot tadi disampaikan, dan juga disampaikan oleh teman kita dari Bangladesh. Saya sangat setuju dengan hal tersebut. Dan ya tinggal ke depan bagaimana kita sekarang meritis tindak lanjutnya, kita bicarakan lagi, kami siap. Terima kasih.
Thank you very much, Pak Ian. And then I will pass this to quickly to Krista and Pete again. But before that, let me just summarize that Pak Ian also mentioned about the role of women. We saw directly from Ms. Farida. She explained so the role of women, and also Pak Ian mentioned about women and men have diverse capacity that can work effectively with one another. It's clear that the combination of these two countries will provide a powerful learning experiences. I believe not just benefiting the two countries, but also the rest of the world. So maybe then any final comments or remarks coming from both of you, Krista and Pete, complementing or with what has been mentioned from Pak Ahmadul and Pak Ian, over to you. Maybe Krista first and then followed by Pete. Krista, time is yours.
I'm afraid I have no further comments than the ones I've made already. I agree we need a combination of online exchange and maybe, if possible, exchange in person, because online we can reach out to so many more people. It's a bit unfortunate. There were some I hear who wanted to speak from the ground. We haven't heard them. So it may be nice to find two locations in the two countries and let people from the ground speak with good translation so that we hear from those who have been trained and who have gone through a disaster situation and how they managed, where the challenges were, and where they would need more support, more knowledge. That could be another session. As I proposed, we can have a series of sessions if that is desired. So that not only we from the Capitals Exchange, but also those from the ground. That could be quite an enriching experience. I have nothing else to add on. Thank you. And we look forward to continue exchanging with you and listening to you.
Thank you very much, Trista. And maybe if I use Mr. Pitt, remarks is also to have more PhD level research, isn't it, on that. So then the same question to you. Any final comments, suggestions, remarks on our discussion? Over to you, Papit.
Hey, yeah, thank you. And thank you for giving me these ideas for another, for a PhD study. But yeah, no, I have to agree with Krista. We're actually the wrong people who are talking here. It should be the volunteers that we have be able to talk to each other. And well, here's another PhD ID back to this thing. Can we have a three-way WhatsApp group organized so that somebody can translate for our volunteers here in Bangladesh so that they can talk to the volunteers out in Indonesia and really have an exchange going? Young people know these things much better than we do. I don't know TikTok movies or all those things, but if just a simple WhatsApp group and somebody who can help to facilitate the translation both ways, I think that would already go a long way. And sharing some videos when we have our next cyclone coming here, hopefully not too bad, or our next flood, that the volunteers, I'm sure they will be making some videos of what they are doing. They can share this, they can post this, and their colleagues in Indonesia can have a look at that and make some comments, and we can have a simple exchange going that way. It's existing technology. It doesn't take much. So just somebody who knows both languages, who can help to translate, that I think would definitely already go a long way. Added to then having the more formal visits that we have been discussing. So I think, yes, we might be onto something here. Thank you.
Excellent. Thank you very much, Mr. Pitt. It's a great idea to have a platform for sharing. I think that's always a good start. So maybe we can explore further on that. So I think I've checked with the organizers. Unfortunately, our time is up. It's a really interesting and fruitful discussion. And clearly, I've learned so much from Bangladesh and Indonesia on their experiences, the journey, as well as the key learning points coming in from both countries. It's certainly a very pleasure to moderate the sessions. And thank you very much for all of the panelists and speakers. I'll give back the time back to the organizers. Thank you very much.
So ladies and gentlemen, this is the end of plenary session. Once again, thank you so much for all speakers, Mr. Ahmadul Haq, Mr. Pitt Fogten, Ms. Krista Rader, Mr. Ian Kusmadiana, and also our moderator for this session, Mr. Avianto. Thank you so much for a very delightful discussion. And before we come to the end of virtual learning exchange on youth engagement in disaster preparedness and response between Government of Indonesia and Government of Bangladesh, we would like to invite Director Cyclone Preparedness Program, CPP, and Deputy Secretary, Ministry of Disaster Management and Relief, M. MODMR, Mr. Ahmadul Haq, to deliver the closing remarks. The time is yours.
Thank you very much. Actually, I have talked much, and we are almost out of Houston. So I just giving thanks to Indonesian government, WFP Indonesia, and of course WFP Bangladesh. Lot of appreciation from Bangladesh government, more specifically Ministry of Disaster Management, and of course from Cyclone Preparedness Volunteer. I am giving thanks to all of you from our 76,000 volunteers. Thank you very much. Have a wonderful day.
Thank you, Mr. Ahmadul Haq, for your closing remarks. And we also like to invite, in this special occasion, Deputy Country Director, Program and Strategy, BDCO, to deliver his closing remarks. For Mr. Pete Fakten, the time is yours.
Hey, thank you very much. I would like to thank everybody who has been here today for making this a real interesting webinar. And thank you also to my colleague Krista and her team, whom I know have put a lot of work in this to make this happen. And a special thank you to our colleagues from the Ministry of Disaster Management and Response in Bangladesh for being available and really engaging positively in this. So thank you, everybody, and have a good rest of the day.
Thank you, Mr. Pete Fakten, for your closing remarks, and thank you very much for being here with us to join this very special event. So ladies and gentlemen, next we would like to invite Ms. Krista Rader, WFP Representative Indonesia Country Office, to deliver her closing remarks. For Ms. Krista Rader, the time is yours.
Let me join the previous speakers in saying thank you for this enriching exchange. Special thanks to Mr. Ahmadul Haq from the Ministry of Disaster Management and Relief in Bangladesh. Special thanks to Pak Ian Kusmadiana, Director of Social Protection for disaster victims in the Ministry of Social Affairs in the government of Indonesia. Thank you to all the other speakers. Thank you to Pete Fakten in Bangladesh and his team. And thank you to our team here in WFP Indonesia, who, yes, put a lot of work into preparing for this event. Stay well, stay healthy, have a good rest of the Ramadan, and have a wonderful Eid al-Fitr. An advanced Eid Mubarak.
Thank you, Ms. Krista Rader, for your closing remarks. Thank you for your attending in this very special occasion. Stay safe and stay healthy for you. So ladies and gentlemen, the last closing remarks will be delivered by Director Social Protection for Disaster Victims, Dr. Andes Ian Kusmadiana, MPSSP. The time is yours.
Terima kasih.
pertemuan yang sangat menyenangkan. Pertemuan yang sangat menyenangkan pada siang hari ini, kami mengapresiasi kepada teman-teman WFP yang telah memfasilitasi ini, dan ucapan terima kasih juga disampaikan kepada teman-teman dari Bangladesh yang telah juga menjadi partner kami mulai saat ini untuk kegiatan penanggulangan bencana, baik itu untuk kegiatan-kegiatan berdiskusi ataupun kita lihat ke depan selanjutnya. Dan tentunya kami mengucapkan terima kasih juga kepada seluruh teman-teman Tagana Indonesia yang saat ini live ikut di channel yang di luar 122 ini, ada juga yang ikut ratusan orang melalui YouTube yang kita lakukan di sini. Terima kasih semua dan salam kemanusiaan.
Thank you, Mr. Ian Kusmadiano, for your closing remarks. So, ladies and gentlemen, now we have come to the end of virtual learning exchange on youth engagement in disaster preparedness and response between Government of Indonesia and Government of Bangladesh. I would like to thank again our speakers for their very interesting and stimulating contributions. And thank you all participants for the valuable following discussion. On behalf of the organization, amazing company, thank you very much for being here and join this event virtually. So enjoy the rest of this day. Stay safe, stay healthy. I'm Fenabella Arin. Good afternoon and see you.